You know, basically, we had this meeting because there's trees, the loss of trees, removal of trees is a huge concern up here. So I felt the need to have this community meeting so that folks could air their questions and have them answered by the experts that were involved in the tree removal, and then have Greg Giusti and Korinn Woodard from NRCS and Greg Giusti from UC Cooperative Extension come and talk about the reforestation and erosion control. And I think it was very successful. I think, you know, people got their questions answered. The room was packed full of people that had very good questions, and I don't think it's going to be the end of it. I think we've got a lot more work to do, and there'll probably be more of these meetings that that will involve this subject. LakeCountyLAC.com will have updated information, contact information for all the folks that were here to give presentations, PG&E, Caltrans, and that, and where they can pick up wood chips. Just any information that was given out here tonight will also be on our website.
Okay, can I have your attention? The misfortune to show up to a meeting that I hold will know that I start on time, and I know there are going to be a lot of people filing in, and hopefully they'll catch the information that we have. Thank you so much for making the trip, and I don't have a boom for this microphone, so hopefully you can hear me. If not, no? Okay, well, you know what? I'll take it off and use it like this. Is that better?
Yes.
All right, my name's Rob Brown, and thank you guys all so much for coming to discuss. I mean, there's so much to discuss about this entire event. You know, the fire, the rebuild, there's gonna be years and years of recovery in this, but this single issue is so important to the people, especially on Cobb and Anderson Springs, because we all know that it is probably the single most important reason that people decided to build and live on Cobb is because of the forest. And we get that. We totally get that. We get that it's that much of that has been lost, and it'll take years to get it back, but it will come back. And I'd like to thank David Leonard. Is he here? You know, David Leonard, the principal of this school, and Catherine Stone, the superintendent of Middletown Unified School District. You know, they've been through so much with the kids, and to be able to bring our kids back to this school is a really big deal. And it's to me, it's a sign of the first steps in rebuilding a community is to be able to have our kids back in their school where they belong, where they need to heal themselves. So many of whom lost their own home. So it's very important to have them. Thank you, David. What I'm going to do, we're going to talk about different aspects of the tree removal, why they were removed. I know a lot of people think, you know, the trees looked good, they look healthy, why not give them a chance? And I get that, we all get that, but there are scientific reasons that that had to occur, and we're going to have people that are experts in that field talk about that, people that you know. So we're going to be talking about that, and we're going to talk about why there's going to be a continued effort to remove trees, and why we're going to encourage people to remove trees that aren't necessarily in county, PG&E, or Caltrans, or AT&T right-of-way, which is predominantly where the trees came from that were removed. The trees that were removed were in those rights-of-way. So we're going to talk about that, and we're going to get through that whole part of the program with the agencies and companies that are responsible for the removal of the trees, and then we're going to talk about the erosion control measures that will be taking place, as well as reforestation, which is something that you know, it's again going to take years, but it's a process that we have to begin now in order for these later generations to enjoy the forest as much as we have up to this point. And then we'll have questions and answers. Your questions that you have that you came here with haven't been answered by the time we're through this presentation, then we'll have plenty of time to answer those questions. So I'm going to begin right now with a good friend of mine who is the division chief for Cal Fire, and he's raised on this mountain. He knows every inch of it, and he's worked for Cal Fire for years and years, and he is an expert on trees and on forests. And so I'm going to ask Jim Wright if he could come up and speak to the reasons for cutting down a tree in general.
Thanks, Rob. Everybody hear me okay? So when you look at a tree and you see a little bit of green up in the top, that's not an indicator of survivability always. It's a good sign, but it doesn't mean it's the only thing that somebody evaluating the tree on its survivability is going to look at. Something very important to tree survivability is the layer in between the bark and the wood called the cambium. And around the base of the tree, well, the cambium runs the length of the tree between the bark and the wood. But what happens is you'll see the burn scars anywhere from a foot or so all the way up the tree, and it varies depending on the severity of the fire. But that little bit of live tissue in there under the bark called the cambium, it cooks. And once it gets cooked, it can kill the tree. So something that you have to look at is not just the green crown, but when we mark trees on the state forest, we'll actually use a hatchet. And it sounds brutal, but you have to cut into the base of the tree and look at that cambium. And normally it's a little thin layer, maybe a 16th of an inch thick. It's white, fleshy, and juicy. And what happens when it cooks, it gets brown, it turns brown, and gets sticky. And it's very easy to tell once you make a small cut into the under the bark to see if the cambium layer is dead or not. Now it's going to vary on the tree what percentage of the cambium is dead. It's not always all the way around. Sometimes one side of the tree burns, sometimes it all the way around burns. So you have to check. We check four quarters. Another part of it is just experience, looking at the tree, looking at the needle freeze. Sometimes when the fire hits a tree, a green tree, and it's so hot, it'll lock the needles in position, all pointing the same direction, kind of the way the wind was blowing at the time. That's a pretty severe burn. When you see the needle freeze, needle lock up, it's probably a dead tree. There are some trees where you'll see a little bit of green left up in there, and the buds are actually protected by the needles that wrap around that bud. Occasionally in the springtime, some of those buds will resprout. So if the cambium is uninjured or very minor injury, you know, less than 20-25% of it, and those buds are protected and there's some green, it is possible that in the springtime some of those trees may bud out. But it's a risk, because they may not. Bark beetles will start attacking. And I think everybody in here has seen the bark beetle attack before the fire, the large patches of dead trees. So the bark beetles are endemic. They're here all the time. They're almost epidemic now, except for in bogs where we killed them all with the fire. But the bark beetles are already attacking some of those burnt trees. And if you look around the very base of them, you'll see red pitch tubes or red boring sawdust, red frass. Red turpentine beetles are already entering that tree because they know it's damaged and it can't defend itself. So that's another sign a forester or an arborist is going to look for, is are they under insect attack? So the more live crown you have, the better the chance the tree is going to survive. The less cambium damage that you have, the better the chance the tree is going to survive. Boring beetles, you know, your tree may have a good chance. But without looking at anybody's individual tree, I couldn't tell you if a tree is going to make it or not without actually examining it. And even at best, it's not an exact science. I mean, we can use guidelines that have worked in other areas, but this fire was extremely hot. Out of all the fires you go to in your career, at 95% of them, this are pretty average. This one was in that 100th percentile, is what I've been saying. It's just extremely hot. Third worst fire in California's history. It did more damage And we haven't always seen all that kind of damage when we're actually marking other timber. Some of it doesn't cook as hot as this stuff did. So depending on where you're at and how black the trees are around it and stuff, it gives you a pretty good idea what to look for. So we can offer some help. I mean, if you have an individual tree, I can't run out to everybody's house, but if you have a real concern and you really need to see somebody, you can get a hold of me, and we'll try and get somebody out to take a look at your tree.
We'll do some questions. If you have questions of Jim, we'll get to those here in a little bit. Danny, did you have something to add to it?
You should touch on the hardwoods, too, because that might be slightly different.
Oh, good point, yeah.
Hardwoods have a better chance of, you can defoliate a hardwood and have it still come back. So just because the leaves turn brown on your oak tree doesn't mean it's dead. The same criteria applies to the cambium layer on an oak tree. If you kill it all, you're probably going to kill the tree. But they can take more defoliation and still sprout back in the spring. That's not the only, it doesn't mean your tree's going to live or die. You're going to have to look at how intense that fire was on that bark, whether it killed it or not. Even the ones that are dead above ground, a lot of them will sprout back. Black oak's a pretty good stump sprouter, so once those trees are cut off, they have a really large root system to support the tree that's above ground now, but once that tree's gone, it's got that root system to send up new shoots. And you'll see some of these black oak trees will grow 3 to 6 feet in a year. Maybe not the first year, but second year, they grow pretty fast. So, any other questions?
Jim, what about Madrone?
Madrone really takes it in the shorts on a fire. It's got real thin bark and it's pretty easily damaged. So,
thank you, Jim. So, one of the things that you'll hear tonight is, and I know there's a lot of people that feel this way, that you know they have a tree and you just want to give it a chance. You want to see if it'll make it through the spring. Also, you know, it's case by case, it's all different, but you've got to consider where the tree is and what damage it could do if it comes down as a hazard tree sometime this winter when we're expecting heavy rains, wind, and that type of thing. If you're wanting to rebuild your insurance, I mean, there's so many things to consider on where those trees are. So keep that in mind if a tree is marginal and you need to have somebody come out and look at it. You know, Cal Fire, you know, Jim said that they'll come out and take a look at it. You can get somebody to come take a look at it and listen to their advice, because they're not going to intentionally cause you to kill a tree that's going to make it. It's just not, that's not what anybody here is for. So if they tell you that this tree's probably not going to make it, it needs to come down. So, Steve?
I think I can speak for a lot of people. I don't think anyone has any concern about CDF determining whether a tree's dead or not, or danger of cutting. I don't think anybody has a problem with that, or their expertise. I think the question has been the huge number of private tree cutting companies in here. What level of expertise do they have? And I can quantify one example. A neighbor asked me to look at a piece of property. I'm a biologist. I actually hired at my own expense a registered professional forester to look at these trees. They used the Forest Service's technique. Out of 21 trees dropped, he determined using U.S. Forest Service's Smith and Cluck technique that of those, 5 were dead. The other trees out of that 21 had either a moderate or an excellent chance of surviving or were uninjured. But they were dropped anyway, well into the property.
We're going to talk about the markings that were on the tree and who may have done that. We're going to get to that because there are identifying marks on these that, you know, we're all going to be held accountable for the trees that we cut down, be able to explain why that happened. So that's, you know, we have people here that, you know, county, PG&E. Is anybody from AT&T showing up yet? No, okay. No, Larry, just because you have a phone bill does not make you with AT&T.
Just real quick.
Yeah.
If you see a red dot on your tree, it means what? And if you see a green
dot. That's what we're gonna talk about. Yeah, we're gonna talk about that. I'm gonna have everybody identify what their mark is when they when they come up. We're gonna go ahead.
I was just gonna say that
On my property, about 8 trees were marked with an X. They were taken down. And another 16 mature trees were taken down that had no marks on them whatsoever.
Okay. We'll get to that. I don't know what the answer to that is. I mean, unless, and I tried to encourage people earlier on, if you think somebody's cutting a tree down, call me. I don't care if 2 o'clock in the morning somebody's got a chainsaw. I want to go out and talk to the guy with the chainsaw. And so, you know, and I'd given my number out to everybody who claimed that. So I did make it available. But we'll get to that. We'll get to questions here pretty quick. I'll talk about county, the trees that the county has done, and then I'll ask Scott to be close by in case there are some things that should ask Scott Daly with Public Works. The county had trees that we had to cut down, and they were marked with a white circle with a white dot.
Or a ribbon.
Pardon?
Or a flag.
Or a ribbon in the county right away. So if you see those trees and you had some concern about that, those are our trees, and we need to figure out if there were any mistakes made on that. Those trees are, they're our responsibility, and with the rains coming up and the anticipation of the probability of flooding, because a lot of this ground out here, the clay and the serpentine soil and all that, it was baked. It was like run through a kiln. And so the water's going to be running off, and it's going to be taking everything that's on top of it more than just soaking in, just absorbing in. So we want to make sure that the slash is out of the ditches, make sure all the ditches are clean, culverts are clean, bridges, Caltrans, we're all working on that to try to make sure that that's ready to go for winter, because there are some areas prone to flooding, but there's also landslide, and we want to make sure that the water's flowing like it should and gets down to Lake Berryessa as quickly as possible if it's headed that way, Clear Lake if it's going that way. So the county, we're working with a contract right now to make sure that those trees are removed. And a lot of these trees, everybody has different criteria, and I don't know what ours is as far as the size of the tree, but we're going to be chipping a lot of this, and we're going to be using the chips for erosion control. So you're seeing a lot of that. I know anybody that's driving down to Middletown sees that with Caltrans, and they'll speak to that. And the trees that they're chipping look big, and they are actually pretty big, but they're not so big that they could be used for lumber or anything like that. They need to be chipped, and they're going to be of good use for erosion control. So I just want to make sure people understand that. Yes.
Does the county have funding for the road department to be able to come through our subdivisions and actually do the ditches?
We're actually working with Cal OES on a lot of that kind of stuff right now. The source of the funding, we had a meeting about that today, but yes, that will be done. You know, and just so you know, there are a few people here who have dealt with potholes over the years that haven't called me for the last month, but the reality is a lot of these roads were tore up from bulldozers and excavators and a lot of equipment, and so we're looking at funding for that, so hopefully the roads will be in better shape than they were before the fire. Yes?
Will the chipped material be available to citizens, to the public?
You'll have plenty of opportunity for chips. Yeah. Yeah. If anybody gets on you for stealing chips, you call me. Yes. That's not going to be a problem.
So.
Pardon me? We'll get to that. We'll get to some questions. Let's get through the presenters first, and then we'll get to that. Actually, this is a method to stall because I don't have the answer, but I can get it while somebody else is talking. There's going to be chips all over the place. There's chips down at Adam Springs at the turnoff down there at Harrington Flat. I mean, there's going to be chips everywhere, and no one's going to get on you about picking up chips. So at this time, I'd like to ask the Caltrans representative to come up, and I didn't, I don't know which of you.
Phil Frisbie.
Come on up. Phil Frisbie with Caltrans.
That's okay. So I'm, as I said, Phil Frisbie. I'm the Public Information Officer of Caltrans District 1 that covers Lake and Mendocino counties. And while I am not a long-term resident like some of the other people you've already heard from, I did grow up in Mendocino County, and my mother lives in Lucerne, thankfully on the other side of the lake from this. So I'm down here regularly, and I do have a connection to the community here. And also, for the during the first 4 weeks of response after the Valley Fire started, I spent 10 days down here on loan to Lake County OES helping get information out and just doing whatever I could to, you know, just to help out and, you know, get things going. And you know, mostly, like I said, getting accurate information out, so, and that's very important. Just kind of an overview of what Caltrans is doing. So Caltrans, particularly along 175, we have some areas, we have a normal right-of-way where we own a certain number of feet past the white line, but in much of it, it's prescriptive. We have prescriptive rights, which means that we basically have the rights to address anything that could, that's close enough to affect the highway. And in the case of these many, many trees that have been damaged, we are responsible for, you know, to keep these trees from falling within the highway. Now, all trees that are marked along the highway, they are being inspected by our arborist, who is trained to he is an expert to do that, and they're being marked with X's, and then our contractor, Granite Construction, in particular, they have a number of subcontractors that are coming through and then removing those trees. The trees along that are within the highway, right away, we are hauling them off. We're still working out the details on that. I've been working with Supervisor Brown on some ideas on how that could benefit the community. As he said, we have to be careful as a state agency. We cannot just give things away to private citizens because that would be considered a gift of state funds. However, we can give things away to local agencies, possibly local nonprofits. So we are looking at some ways that we can get rid of some of this. Now, the trees that we are cutting that were marked on private land, our crews, as they're out there, they are attempting to contact the landowner. And if we can't contact the landowner, then the tree's being dropped onto the private property. It's being cleaned up, you know, the limbs are being removed, and then the tree is being left there for the owner's use because it is the owner's tree. If it can't be felled, you know, safely onto the private property, has to be, you know, go onto the highway, then of course we are removing it for safety. Now, it was just brought to my attention just before this meeting. Now, we are not clear cutting along the highway. There are many places where the trees are very, very damaged, and we are removing most of them. But in as many as we can, our arborist, Darren, he is trying to use judgment to look for trees that might have a decent chance of survival. And so those trees are being skipped, and that's why you'll see along places, you'll see some trees taken and some trees are not. So we are trying to use our best judgment while ensuring the safety of the highway system, especially this first winter. I know that you were going to be addressing erosion control later. Do you want me to mention erosion control? Okay. So along the highway, we're going to be converting a lot of those trees to wood chips. They make very good erosion control, help keep the rain from turning the surface of the soil to mud and running off. But we are going to be passing around a list. In fact, our resident engineer for this project, Garrett Griffith, he has a sign-up sheet. And if you are a landowner and you have your property is right along 175, then if you sign this, then he will contact you. And if you're agreeing that you would allow our contractor to perform some sort of erosion control, if that is appropriate. So if your property is a hillside coming down to the highway, then we will be able to do some, in a lot of areas, we will be able to do some erosion control to help stabilize that. Probably with chips, I'm not sure about any other measures, but as we said, you know, you're gonna see piles and piles of chips, and while we cannot tell you that you can go out and grab those chips, I have to tell you that those are the state of, you know, they're owned by the state of California, but I don't think that anyone's going to be calling the sheriff's department if they see people out there taking chips and they're using them for erosion control. So I think that's all I have, just for a summary.
What are you marking your trees with? What color?
Well, we're only using orange paint, orange X's, but I understand that some others, because of a shortage of paint, may have been using orange too for other things. But the ones right along the highway that are orange, those should have been inspected by our arborist. There was a question over here?
Same question.
Same question, okay. Yes.
How do we talk to the person who actually marked these trees?
Well, let's see. How can they talk to the person that marked the trees? And Darren, would you like to address that?
I'm right here. I can hand in my card if you guys ask questions of the trees around here. But like Phil was saying, you know, Cobb's a beautiful place. The trees are great, but we want the highway safe, so we're getting rid of the trees that have no chance to survive.
Yes.
What about the secondary roads other than 175?
Well, it's Caltrans is only working on 175.
In previous permits that I've had with Caltrans, chips were not allowed to be used because they don't let native grow up through them. They're good at protecting. I love them, don't get me wrong. But the fact is that they shield and shadow the ground to the extent that they're not going to let enough light through to cause germination. This is what you have told me. So I had to use rice straw or barley, something that wouldn't go beyond the annuals.
Yeah, and Robert, in normal situation, that's the case, but there's not enough rice straw out there to take care of this. And so if it's a problem for individual landowners, private property, small lots, and it gets us through the winter, we can always remove them and find someplace to get rid of them.
I was going to say, long term, after this year, are we going to look back at some reseeding or some avenue of lighter erosion control methods?
Sure, and Caltrans is still working. We have staff that are working on various erosion control and replanting issues that are going to be occurring. Some this winter and then ongoing in order to restore more and stabilize more areas. There's a question over here.
Yeah, not a question, it's a fact. Someone with license plate 6YUE380 left their lights on.
What kind of car is it? Because I don't even know what my license plate number is.
What car was it? It's a gray car, I don't know.
Okay, let's see. Back here.
I have a question, particularly involves the straw. What's Caltrans going to do about non-native invasive species, especially if you put straw down? We already have a problem with star thistle and Scotch broom, and now is the time to eradicate them, not bring more of it in here.
Well, as part of Caltrans standard specifications, any straw that we bring in along the highway, it has to be certain specifications, and it has to be clean. So, in order to reduce, the chance of bringing in non-natives, that's a great issue. In fact, any seed we purchase has to be certified, has to be below a certain percent.
Yeah, but I guess I'm asking a question. Okay, that's great, but you're still going to have non-natives introduced. What's going to happen to the non-natives? Because it seemed like nothing was happening beforehand to stop the spread of it.
You know, I'm not sure even how much straw is being used on our construction. I know
that's not the issue. That just might make it worse. But with all the bare ground, those two plants will thrive where a lot of the natives will have a hard time getting started. So that stuff would take off like a torrent. And once it's established, there is no getting rid of it.
Oh, sure. And as I said, we have specifications to prevent the transfer of non-native species in the straw and any seed we bring in. So it's a very, very low.
I'm asking you, when it gets here, which it will, and it's already here, and it's going to re-sprout, are you going to spray? What are you going to do?
Well,
Let's try to stay focused on the tree thing. I understand your issue is important, but you're going to have to contact them offline because we could be here for a while with that. And I'm trying to, you know, this probably is working out better to answer some of these questions right away, but we'll try to get through the program to do the questions too. So right back here.
I just wanted to know, you said if you try to get a hold of the landowner, where do I go to make sure the county has my new phone number, since I couldn't port my Cobb number and I'm out of it?
We'll talk about that.
I'm going to
explain some of the details here.
Right, and this sign-up sheet, if there may be a chance for us to do some erosion control right along the edge of the highway on your property, if you sign up, you can provide us with your phone number. Yes.
I've heard 175 State Route. What's happening on Bottle Rock?
As far as the
erosion control goes.
Same thing. County's doing pretty much the same thing that Caltrans is doing, only on a smaller scale. Their task is huge, but we're doing the same thing.
And will it go beyond the fire zone? Will it go up?
Eventually, but right now their focus is on the fire zone. And I know Linda Juntman's here, and there's some effort to, on the Fire Safe Council, there's some effort to do some areas to clear brush and that to limit exposure.
And there's still some Caltrans?
Still? Okay, Jessica?
I'm not Jessica, but can you repeat the questions as they're asked so we all know what you're answering?
Yeah. Okay.
So we all get benefit from it? Thank you.
We'll do that. Good enough. Jessica?
No, be 4-H like right now, Rob.
What's that?
Be 4-H like. Repeat the question. Can't even hear me.
Be 4-H like.
Be 4-H like. As in 4-H. Repeat the question.
Repeat the question.
Okay, I will. That's what she said. Okay, I got you. I'm sure you're like, ask the question and I'll repeat it.
I have a question in regards to the soil and the slopes that have been compromised. Obviously, there's erosion control, but for those areas that have been especially compromised, is there a plan in the future for any sort of retaining walls and the timber that's being pulled out? That is timber that could be used for something like that long term. Is there a plan for that to be used toward that in the future?
On Caltrans property?
Yes.
First, as far as retaining walls go, I mean, I'm not aware of any initial. Right now, it's just a restoration, getting it back and getting it buttoned up so that we can. You know, we have no idea. You know, we're getting conflicting information from the National Weather Service whether we're going to be average or above average right now. So we really don't know. So, you know, we'll just have to monitor. We'll continue to monitor the highway into the future just as we have in the past. If there is a long-term issue with an area, slides develop because of this, loss of vegetation, we may have to address that. We may just have to cut back some slopes. As far as the wood goes, I'm not aware that this wood would be appropriate for any restoration like that.
I was looking at more temporary, at least until we start to really understand what weather is coming at us, especially if there's any fir or even woods that could handle a little bit more than pine, or maybe even some of the slab from the pine. Something temporary.
Check dams.
Sure. You know, I guess that's what's being developed right now for each individual area, depending upon how, you know, what sort of vegetation was there, what's left, the slopes, and then that sort of thing. We have people that are working on that right now, and so that's going to be ongoing for the next probably several years, especially as we get into replanting, you know, native vegetation. Yes.
Will there be an effort by Caltrans to replant any along the corridor?
Yes.
Especially native, obviously.
Yes, yes. Any replanting that we do, and they are working on that, deciding what's appropriate, and it will all, you know, it will always be native plants, definitely. Yes.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify. You said if you cut a tree on a private property owner's property, you're not going to do any erosion control on the private property, only on the public right-of-way, is that correct?
No, no, and that's what this sign-up sheet is for. Is generally, we would not do erosion control on private property. You know, it's this is an unusual situation. Our normal procedure for when we spot trees that are on private property that are in potentially a dangerous highway, we would notify the owner first, write them a letter, give them a certain number of days for them to hire their own, arborist or, tree company to address the issue. And then only if they did not respond or didn't wish to respond, would we go ahead and we would actually then remove it and we would drop it. And then we would send them a bill. So we are not billing for any of this work. It's all being covered under this emergency contract under Granite Construction. It's just, like I said, it's very unusual circumstances. And so, there are so many trees out there, and that's what, our arborist is trying where he can. He is trying to leave trees so that where he can. That doesn't mean that they're not going to get removed over the next few years, because those are going to get inspected later, and some of those that he hopes are going to recover, will not recover. That's just the way it's going to be. So we'll do we'll remove as few as we can for safety. There was a question there.
I was going to ask about you putting concrete retaining walls or barriers on the sloping land where I ride a motorcycle. You're at a corner, the gravel and stuff, it's dead. There's lots of bikes up here.
Or again, about retaining walls. I mean, that's something that, ongoing, just as part of our normal, review, we will have to address issues like that. But that's down the road.
Happens, or are you going to take a preventive measure and put these in place so that any loose gravel and stuff comes in, gets stopped by that?
We'll be monitoring the highway, and if there are areas, I see what you're saying, like the movable metal barrier, the K-rail we call it. Yeah, if there are areas that are, this winter, they're generating rocks, then we will address that. We'll put out some temporary barrier. That's our normal procedures.
The guys that every day doing it, I guess they're clearing it. I look at the geysers, and we got hit pretty hard in there. And the road, I drive around that facility all day, and there's rocks and stuff dropping all over the place because there's no one there maintaining like there is at the moment. So I don't think it's going to take much for there to be boulders and gravel and stuff dropping all over those corners.
Right, and for any new issues that are occurring, they're showing up with areas where possibly there's going to be some new slides or rocks falling down, off of hillsides that are now unstable. We will follow our normal procedures, and we will be looking out for those, and we will address those, for this next year and ongoing. And I think there was a question back there first.
I just wanted to ask about, there's an easement for different agencies, PG&E, AT&T, Cal Fire, Caltrans, and there's arborists from various organizations that each agency has hired. And what I want to know is there an oversight? Who oversees this? And what does the county, is there any county or state engagement in overseeing the process to see that the arborists agree with one another? Or to see that there's cohesiveness and
repeat the question?
Yes, I'm curious about that.
The question was, is that what, all of our, Caltrans and Cal Fire and the other agencies, PG&E and AT&T, we all have our own arborists that we have on staff. And the question was there any oversight or any agreement on protocols? And I think the basic answer is as far as standard protocols, no. Our arborists are all, we have professional arborists, and PG&E's requirements for trees, I don't want to speak for them, but their requirements for trees are different than ours. Just from what little I've told, I've been told. They're protecting power lines, we're protecting the highway. And we have different needs. And so, but our arborists, all meet, they're all qualified.
I have faith in your arborists, and I just wondered if someone might be able to answer at some point. Who oversees that entire process? There has to be somebody who can look from above or part of the table and actually look at those and see.
The agency that everybody kind of answers to, I'm not saying they work. Cal OES is who we go to. We've been going to for answers for these things. They're not physically responsible for what PG&E does or anything. But what I've learned is if we have a problem with PG&E, AT&T, if somebody has a problem with county, we go to OES, and then they're kind of the umbrella agency that tries to resolve whatever that issue is. That's been my experience so far in this process.
And then you're next back there.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Bill, on more than one occasion, I know of properties adjoining on Highway 175 that have written contracts over the years for improvements installed by Caltrans, which then they were responsible for maintenance. Things like slope control, which is on private property, where a driveway would be put in, but once the trees are removed, and these contracts were very specific. They said these trees will stay, these won't, okay? Are those going to be superseded by these new policies where Caltrans is going to come in and do that with cost?
Well, as far as he was saying, we have right of way agreements with probably with some property owners for various improvements or maybe in exchange for some access or something like that. As far as trees, we're going to have to evaluate. We will be evaluating all trees that could possibly fall into the highway, and. You know, our arborist, Darren, he will be, you know, evaluating all those trees, and he's going to have to make that decision. So I would say in some ways, if for safety, you know, that safety will, unfortunately, will override. It just like if those trees got diseased and we identified them, then we would be sending you a letter if those trees could fall into the highway for you to address them.
Like, for example, one case, I know that the weed poles have melted down because they were PVC from the fire. They're no longer functioning. And they are slope controlled downhill of Highway 175.
Right, the drainage coming
right.
out of the hills.
The road in this particular case is already showing cracks of subsidence into the creek.
Darren, is that emergency contract addressing those slope drainage? Because I've seen there's areas where there's PVC pipe into the is that part of this emergency contract?
We're addressing different plastic culverts. We're checking every metal culvert in that for any damage or blockage.
Right. Yeah.
So we'll be looking at all different drainage.
So we're taking care of drainage, and that's going to include this drainage out of the hillsides. Okay. So we are going to be looking at that to address that and repair those. So yes.
I think that I always like it when you guys, who are the professionals, do your presenting first. I think you oftentimes answer a myriad of our questions if you just do the presenting first. I think this could go on until 2 o'clock in the morning the way we're going here.
Yeah.
It's just an observation.
It's nice to ask these questions because there are probably other people in the room that have the same question, but a lot of this stuff could be taken offline. And we have a website. It's lakecountylac.com. All of the contact information for all of these agencies that you're hearing from will be, if they're not, on that website. Is that correct, Jill?
Yes. Just about 2 days.
Okay. We'll have all that information on that website so that you can contact for a lot of these things that could be taken offline, as well as locations for where you can find chips. So we'll work that out. What's that? It's lakecountylac.com. So hopefully that helps, and we'll have, you know, there'll be CAL FIRE information there. We'll have all the information that we're getting here tonight and then some. We have a lot of information that people need. How many of you, by a show of hands, I know there are people from out of the area here too, but how many by a show of hands actually live in the burn area? Okay, so there are a few that don't. How many of you lost your homes? And how many are you going to rebuild?
What was that percentage?
What's that?
What was that percentage of the current rebuild?
Well, I don't know. It was just it was not very high. I'd like to see more hands. Yeah, so we're going to be contacting a lot of you as we're doing the cleanup on the lots. That's one of the things that if you get this question, if the health department, environmental health calls you and they ask you what the probability is of rebuild, we need to know that, because we're planning a lot of things up here that I don't want to get into t- tonight because we're almost an hour into this just on trees, and we're not even halfway done. But we have a lot of things in plan, you know, water systems, you know, just a lot of stuff that we're going to be doing, and a lot of it depends on the percentage of rebuild. So we need to get that percentage up high so we can do this right and make this a place that you guys all want to come back to again. Yes, sir.
One thing I think a lot of people are thinking, and I feel bad for Darren, to be honest with you, because 175 is really a lot, and there's a lot of trees, and you guys are talking about how he has to check everything, and before he tells them when they get cut down. That has to be a lie, number one. It can't be possible that he's been able to do it all on his own. So my question is, why is there only one arborist being used for this area on 175?
Well, Darren is, he has been staying ahead of the crew.
I feel bad for him.
But,
well, after hearing from Cal Fire how, you know, you have to check different things for each tree, and it just feels like he can't do a thorough job.
There's probably some of them that are pretty obvious.
But still, I mean, that's just, I can understand for an area where there's not a lot of trees, this is, like everyone said, a different extreme circumstance. So why haven't there been more arborists coming in to be able to verify that stuff, if it's an issue, which obviously it is?
Everybody hear the question?
Yeah. Why doesn't Caltrans have more arborists?
Exactly. Just one.
So as far as now, you've been, now Darren, you've been keeping ahead of the work.
Well, Caltrans has a tree crew in Ukiah.
Right. Yeah, Caltrans has a tree crew in Ukiah.
I've trained those employees how to check trees too. They're not certified, but they've been trained how to.
Okay, but so they've been helping you check the trees, but you're the one giving the final, the mark. Okay, so he does have some other tree crew personnel there helping him identify trees, but he's giving the final. But he is the only one marking. Well, as I said, you know, all I can answer is the ones that are within that Caltrans has been marking.
Because orange Caltrans marks.
Well, other unfortunately, other agencies we have not had an official color code. You know, we haven't been using like the markings on for the underground services, because that question came up when I was helping out Lake County OES is there a color code? Can we tell by the color? And the answer is no, because Caltrans is only using orange X's, but other people were using whatever color, you know, as they were running out of paint, they were using whatever color they could get.
Do these trucks break out on a commission basis on how many trees they cut, or are they paid just to do a job? It seems like they're cutting down a lot of trees. I mean, it seems like there's a bit of money there. You know, the more trees they cut down, the more money they make.
The question was, is the crew that are coming out here, are they getting paid by the tree? So, I guess the idea is that would they be trying to cut extra trees? And my understanding is no. This contract is just for a flat amount. It's an emergency contract. And no, they are not getting paid by the tree. So they, in fact, that would be a disincentive for them to cut more than we've marked, because they're not getting any extra money. So I doubt that would be occurring. Let's see, there was a hand back here, and then yes.
What, if anything, will Caltrans be doing to keep the right of way as a shaded fuel break? After some replanting takes over, to keep it deep brushed, your right of way.
That's a good question. And
what was the question?
The question was, is what is Caltrans? Because when you remove all these trees that had been growing up against the highway, now you've got open areas, and that's going to tend to allow the brush to take over rather than the trees, and the brush burns more easily. So there's a concern. So that is a good question for our revegetation specialists who are not represented tonight. But I will make a note of that and see if I can get some information out, because that is a I, you know, I can see where that's a strong concern for this area. Yes.
For trees that are being cut on people's property and the people don't want the trees, how do we deal with removing them?
We'll talk about that in a minute.
Right, and as far as the Caltrans, if we are able to get a hold of the owner, while we're cutting down the trees, if they tell us they don't want them, then we are hauling them off.
How do we do that?
If the trees haven't been cut on your property yet, we'll get your sign up on this. If you have a property that's right next to the highway, sign up on that list for the erosion control, and we will be in touch with you, and we'll see if we can make note of that. And Garrett, I see he's making a note. So talk to him afterwards, and we'll see what we can do. But like I said, this is an unusual situation. So, and I don't want to hog up too much, hog up all this time. But maybe one more question. Yes.
Pete, I have a suggestion for you. You got an empty Caltrans yard down in Middletown that they scrapped about 10 years ago. Why not reactivate that Caltrans yard? So, because Highway 175 is such a mess, it's going to be a mess all winter, so they can jump on it and get the job done faster than having to come from out of area.
The question was, what about reactivating the Middletown Caltrans yard, which was shut down some years back? I don't know that answer, but we have crews here. This Highway 175 is taken care of by the Lakeport crew, and I
down here signed for lunch. I mean,
I understand that, and as they're working through the winter, if they need extra help, I know that they can reappropriate people from other yards if they need to, if this becomes an issue. And like you said, we are going to be monitoring this, and we know that there will be some issues. We know that, and so we will be monitoring it through the winter. So,
is there any way that we could all agree that we hold our questions till the end? And we are going to be here till the end. Everybody just agree to the very end, and then we can move.
So let's move on. Somebody else. Thank you.
Just stand by whoever the question is going to be for. Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Phil. Okay, so we're going to move on now to PG&E, who I think probably had the most trees that were removed for different reasons, all throughout their right-of-way. And for the most part, those are the ones that are actually laying on property that we need to clean up. So we're working with that crew on the removal of that, how that process is going to look. But I asked Carl Schoenhofer to come up, and he's going to speak to PG&E's part of the process. And again, as Jim Rothberg suggested, maybe we could hold off our questions until everybody's presented, and then maybe those questions have been answered.
Good evening. Yeah, I'm Carl Schoenhofer. I'm the Senior Division Manager for PG&E, and the division that I have general responsibility for, whether it's gas or electric, includes Humboldt, Lake, Mendocino, and Trinity counties. And I live in a little town called Hydesville up near Fortuna. I have strong ties to the Lake County area, particularly the Middletown area, so this was a difficult fire to work on for me. But I want to start off by saying I'm pretty proud of PG&E. We deployed a tremendous amount of resources on this fire right from day one to restore power safely and quickly to all the communities impacted by the fire. And we remain committed to the communities that have been impacted by the fire in a number of different ways. We're trying to expedite all the service planning process. And right now, as you're all aware, we're in the process of clearing the fire damaged trees that can potentially impact our lines in the future. We're taking these actions not only to just protect the reliability of our lines for the future, but even more importantly, we're concerned about future fires. If these trees come down and impact our lines, they could create fires in the future. So that's important for us. And as mentioned earlier in the presentation, CAL FIRE, just please remember that even though these trees may look healthy, if that cambium layer near the trunk has been burnt or the canopy is severely impacted, then most likely that tree will die in the future. And then it will be an issue for all of us. and PG&E doesn't want to cut any more trees than any of you want us to cut. But I would like to remind you also that not only are we doing this to meet our own PG&E's safety standards, but we're regulated, and we are required by federal and state regulations to ensure that we clear any trees that have been fire damaged or are hazardous to our electric lines. And these are high voltage power lines. Most of this work is on private property, as you're aware, and we work in your rights of ways. And as a courtesy and under best fire management practices, what we're doing is we lop up that material that's less than 4 inches, and we chip it up and we spread it out anywhere when we're within 100 feet of an accessible roadway. And the material that's 4 inches and greater, we're operating on your right of way, it's your property, it's your trees, and we don't own those trees. We do not take those trees off your property. And it's very rare circumstances in which we do that, and that's always in conjunction with the landowner. And I know that the county, I know that Rob, and I know Jim Comstock, you guys are working on, with other companies to try and develop solutions where there will be outside companies that can take this material, and PG&E is happy to cooperate in that process, and we'll do what we can. So, and I just want to close by saying, you know, we recognize the impact that this has had on your community. We sincerely appreciate your patience and your cooperation as we work through this process. And again, this is not fun for us either, but we're committed to the community, and we're going to do the best we can while we're here. We will also address your concerns as you have them. We have a team of folks here from our veg management team and other folks that can answer your questions one-on-one as you have them. So I don't know the format if you want me to...
We'll come to questions afterwards, so stand by. Okay. One thing that I know I could see a little reaction there about getting these trees off of your land that PG&E has removed. Yeah, what is the color of your X's?
So Rob, when we got here, we saw the Caltrans was using orange, so our buses didn't.
Okay, and in a lot of cases, it's okay. What he said, there are blue X's, there's orange X's, there's
dots, full eyes.
Yeah, is that what he said?
No.
Okay, all right. Okay. I'll clarify a little bit. Yeah. Originally, we started using orange down on Highway 175,
okay.
And I don't know if we intentionally stopped because we saw Caltrans was using the same color, or if we just ran out of orange paint. Okay, so I know we used yellow, I know we used blue, and I know we used white. And so if you're wondering if PG&E was the one that cut your tree down, you can call 1-800-PGE-5000. You create a case and we'll have somebody come out and meet you on your property. But you can generally look, and if your tree isn't near 175, but it's near a power line, you can just about guarantee, and there's a mark on it, an X, you can guarantee that that was, not guarantee, good chance, call PG&E, 1-800-PGE-5000, and we'll have somebody meet you on site. Okay. There were some trees identified prior to the fire that we might have sprayed a dot on. Those are ones that had the bark beetle mortality, and they were scheduled. There was between 2,000 and 3,000 of those trees that were affected before the fire started that we were scheduled to take out. I think most of the property owners were identified and notified of that. I can't be 100% sure, but I'm not aware that we ever used a dot, other than if it was one that was identified before.
Okay, and the other thing that I was going to mention as a result of the question that was back here about the trees that were cut down that weren't marked at all, if they were cut down along with trees that you know that PG&E cut down, call that number, and they'll open a case on that as well. Come on, check that out.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And to open a case, and what difference does it make?
Okay, so if you open a case, you call in, you say, I have a concern, you give your address, and go create a help ticket, and that'll come to the veg management department, and then we'll have one of our arborists know to call you, and then arrange to meet you on site, if that's what you want.
It's not going to bring your tree back, but it's going to help some accountability on why they were cut down. And those numbers, that number that PG&E gave, that he gave for PG&E, is also going to be on lakecountylac.com. A lot of that information is already up and running. That website's been up and running for a long time. There's a lot of information on there, but a lot of the information about wood chips and that will be added to it. Yep.
Maybe in the interest of time, that we have the presentations and have a breakout, PG&E there, Caltrans there, somebody over here afterwards, so that we can answer the questions here, because it's just not going to work. This way we'll be here.
Well, everyone hears what we're talking about here.
Yeah. Yeah. I like the questions asked, and then we can determine whether they can be taken offline or not, if that's okay. Because I think you're right. I think somebody's going to ask a question that a lot of other people have, so we might as well get that over with. But the thing I wanted to get back to was there is ongoing discussion. We're all on the same team here. We're all holding ourselves accountable for the cleanup, the tree removal, the reforestation, all that stuff. We're all, you know, even though we're different agencies and different criteria and different responsibilities, we're all ultimately responsible for what goes on here. We are having ongoing discussions with PG&E, and it's going to be resolved really quick, because your lot can't be cleaned up until those trees are out of there. And so somebody's removing those trees one way or the other. And we're going to make sure that happens, because we're not going to hold up the cleanup of your lot and risk the rains coming down and washing asbestos and all this other crap down the creek because somebody wants to decide, well, that's not my tree to remove or anything like that, because that's just not going to happen. It's not going to get in the way. So, you know, there's a lot of bureaucracy involved that goes up the chain, but right here at this level, I'm telling you right now, those trees are going to be removed one way or the other. The ones that are in the way of the cleanup.
What about all the rest on the property that's felt that are not in the way of the debris field?
Those are probably going to be your trees. I can't tell you. I mean, I don't know what your lot is, but I can give you my phone number. Some people have 40-acre lots. We're not going to clear a 40-acre lot. So, I mean, I can give you my number, though. But if it's a lot like, you know, Anderson Springs or any of the lots up here that, you know, it's obvious that the cleanup cannot occur, some people want to keep their trees. And they may not be able to keep them on that lot if it's going to impede the efforts of the cleanup. That's the main thing that we've got to get through right now before the rain starts, get this cleanup done. So, my number is 349-2628.
Thank you.
And when we talk about, did somebody from AT&T show up yet? No? Okay, so they're the ones that are ultimately responsible for all this. And their number is 611.
Where do I go for resources on what to do with those trees and what my options are?
The question is what to do with the trees, that 16 trees or whatever number are on your property.
Where do I go for my options on what to do with them, and then what resources are available to you?
Well, we should have that on Lake County LAC. We'll work on getting that information, because what you do with your trees may be different.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, they're going to be removed one way or the other. We're finding staging areas right now. If you're at Anderson Springs, we're going to try to find places closer down the flat. We don't want to have to haul them a long ways to get them off the property. We want this to happen quick. We're looking for locations up here on Cobb, you know, different areas where we can get them off your property and start processing them. But in the meantime, if, you know, it all depends. You know, there's a market for some of this stuff, but you're not going to have time to sell it. You're not going to have to. I mean, bottom line, unless they're big old huge, and Greg Giusti will talk about that. Okay. Well, Greg Giusti will talk about that here in just a little bit. He's actually in tune with several options that are available for good trees and the hardwood. The pine is probably not much of a market for that as far as holding on to them, trying to sell them. But the main thing is we've got to get them off your lot. We've got to find some place to get them off so that this cleanup can continue. We can't impede the efforts of the cleanup crew, which are here. The representatives from Pacific States are here, and it's important with the magnitude of you know, all the lots that need to be cleaned up and the ambitious goal of trying to get them all cleaned up before Christmas or by Christmas. That's a huge task, and we don't know what the weather is farther than 10 or 15 days out. So. Again, we're going to go to questions here in just a little bit, but I'm going to go ahead and take a couple, because if you just, yeah.
Okay, what about PG&E trees that are actually blocking road access or across the road? We do not have access to our property. Well, how do we get them to remove them?
Will PG&E remove those?
Absolutely.
Yes, PG&E will remove those, so contact them at that phone number, or contact me and I'll put you in contact with them.
Okay.
So, yeah, I, I didn't want to speak for him, but I was hoping that would be the answer. Yeah, so we
just a little clarification. When you talk about debris removal, mm-hmm. are you talking about structures that have burned and now has ash?
Yeah, that's
not
that's
not wildland or
no, no, debris. Yeah, and thank you for that clarification. The question was, when I'm talking about debris removal, am I talking about
slash?
I'm talking about the foundation, the steel, the ash, you know, the hazardous material, and the asbestos, the heavy metals, and that type of thing. Yeah, we've got to get that out of there before it starts raining. So yes, sir.
Will PG&E or Caltrans chip the trees if the landowner wants them to?
It sounds like that's an option, but that's not knowing where your property is or what kind of trees it is. I don't want to speak for them, but that's something
if
you probably.
If they fell a tree, and instead of leaving it there and leave it.
Okay. Here's one thing that is a little bit of a problem because a lot of these lots are really small, especially down around Anderson Springs. Chipping them and putting them out on the job site right now is a problem because that what you don't want is for them not to be able to find areas that need to be cleaned up, the ash pits or because there are chips laying everywhere. So it's probably best to wait till after the cleanup, unless your lot is so big that you can get outlying areas and things down by the creek and that. Am I correct on that?
Exactly.
Yeah, I had heard somebody say that before from your organization. Yes, sir.
Just one real quick observation about a problem. I was physically present when PG&E marked some of my trees and we negotiated about which ones why. Same with Caltrans. There was no problem with that, but the problem is I was told the blue X meant cut, the yellow X meant watch, and the red dot meant just limb the tree, don't cut it down. But the fallers, there's too many fallers, and they don't know what these codes mean because there is no agreed upon thing, and they're falling everything that has any marking on it.
Anybody that has that problem needs to communicate directly with PG&E to find out what that was, what that's all about, and what could be done about that. Any other, yes?
This is an insurance thing that I'd just like to remind people about. There's two different types of insurance that you need to consider for potential flooding that may occur around your property. There's mudslides, which is an additional rider on your policy. These usually take 30 days to go into effect, so you want to be thinking about this now. Also for flood insurance, think of it as a chocolate shake versus a chocolate cake.
Kim? I know you walked in a little bit late, but we're just talking about trees for right now. We're not talking about anything else. Is this?
I just want to see people be happy.
I know. No, I understand. And we're going to have other meetings about other subjects, but I want to stick to the tree subject right now. Yep.
What are your limitations to having local tree services? Are they able to be contacted by the owners to come in and do work besides like Caltrans and PG&E and all that?
To have them done for private property owners?
Yeah, like if an owner wanted to call a local tree service, they can
hire an independent contractor.
Are there any resources or monies for them besides insurance? Or is
This is my understanding, and I've actually gotten this information from OES, so don't shoot the messenger here. If the tree is standing on your property and it's not in PG&E, county, AT&T, or Caltrans right away, it is your responsibility. We're working on resolving that because that we want to get these trees out of here, these hazard trees, so we want to try to figure out some way for hazard and mitigation. We haven't worked that out yet, but I've been working with Senator McGuire and Assemblymember Dodd to try to determine, you know, how we can best do that. Because, you know, the other issue, as Jim talked about, and Danny and Prather and I have talked about this, these trees, we've got to get them out of here because they're food, they're fuel for the beetles. We've got to get these out of here, stop the cycle. Otherwise, we've got the beetles in here, you know, eating on these trees, and then when they're done there, they're going to move on to better trees. And so we've got to get them out of here. And not only that, but if we want to seriously attract people to come back up to Cobb, we got to get rid of the depressing view of black burned up trees everywhere. I mean, it's sad enough as it is without those trees, but to have all those black, you know, trees just standing there as a reminder, and they're hazard. If somebody's going to build, you or your neighbor are going to build, eventually those trees are going to come down. We'd like to get them down before the people build there and get them down out of there.
Are there funds, though, besides insurance? Do you know of anything?
No, I don't know. That's what I'm saying. We're working on that to try to determine.
I'll touch on that.
Okay. Well, we're getting close to you if you want to talk about that. So maybe she has an answer to that. But in talking to Cal OES about that, and they understand the dilemma as much as we do. We've had good discussions about that. As it is right now, they're saying that it is the responsibility of the landowner to get those trees down that haven't been already cut down by right-of-way entry.
How do you get on a list?
What's that?
How do you get on a list as a private tree service?
Well, you'd have to contact the private property owner as of now. But there's no funding right now to pay them. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I know. But like people needed, the lady over there was asking, how do we find resources to get this work done? Like, you know, the private tree services. There's no like county list or something.
I don't know. Jill, is that something we could work on too on our website for independent contractors?
Yeah, like on that.
Is that a link that we can work on? We'll work on that.
Okay.
We'll work on that. Okay, let's see. I know there were a couple of questions. I was going to ask,
So are you basically saying that it's smart?
I'll repeat the question here in a second.
You're basically saying it's smart to remove all the pine trees, Cobb, because of the pine bark beetle that might be hitting them?
Did I say that? No, I didn't say that. I said remove all of the trees that are black and ruined and dead and hazard trees, yeah. I think that is a good idea.
Okay, but you're also talking about the pine bark beetle.
Yeah.
So you're talking about the dead trees.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. Okay, so Korinn Woodard from NRCS is going to come up and talk about a lot of stuff. Erosion control, other things. And NRCS, it's not NCS.
Nor NCIS. I'm with the Department of Agriculture's Natural Resources Conservation Service. Mouthful, right? I'm the district conservationist here for Lake County, and I just wanted to address, I don't see her anymore, but the question about funding, we do have programs through the Farm Bill that can potentially assist private landowners with the cleanup of trees on a large scale basis, and then the replanting and the associated projects that go with that. So in the back corner, I know half of you can't get there, but at the end of the meeting, there is a sign-up sheet for those of you who want our agency to make contact with you. We'd be glad to do that. We will come out, look at your properties, see what's, you know, what potential projects are there and how our funding might be able to help you.
You said large property. What do you mean?
I mean, we will work with any size landowners. I will say that sometimes there's, with our programs, our funding is usually done on an acreage basis. Like, you know, we pay X amount of dollars per acre, say, to plant trees. Sometimes on a small scale, it's not as effective for landowners. I understand the limitations there, but we will help anybody. We will come out to any site and give information to people. And even if you have up to 10,000 acres, whatever, you know.
What's your phone number?
263-4180, and we're at extension 3.
Your name?
My name is Korinn.
Can you repeat it one more time?
263-4180.
And it'll also be on our website.
Yeah, and there is a sign up in the sheet in the back. Like I said, please get your name on there if you want information from us, and we will reach out to those of you who need assistance.
And I'll answer questions, I guess, you know.
Okay, so at this point, I would ask Greg Giusti to come up. Jim Rothberg, did you want to come up and say
something? He's my straight man.
You guys have the same shirt. Song and dance team. Yeah, Greg Giusti's with the University of California Cooperative Extension, and he is has always been our go-to guy when it comes to forestry issues.
Thank you, Supervisor. I brought some handouts for folks. Obviously, most people are linked up to the internet. For those people with internet access, here's lists of resources that you can go online. I'll leave those up here. I brought about 35 copies of handouts for folks without internet access. It's the same information, but I had my office staff print it all out for you. So before you leave, there's handout stuff up here, as well as another UC publication, Burned Oaks, Which Ones Will Survive. So as Rob said, I'm with the University of California Cooperative Extension. I'm the forest advisor for Lake and Mendocino counties. I'm a registered professional forester, and I'm a trained ecologist. I've lived in Kelseyville since 1989. It really does hurt me to see so many people in the audience that I know that are dealing with this. It's our community, and we'll get it back. Rob wanted me to talk about reforestation, and we've talked about a lot of subjects already. The threat of invasive species, reforestation, natural versus seeds, where are the seeds going to come from, who's going to pay for the seeds, how do we know which trees we should take, which ones we should leave. I've convened a group of forest professionals representing CAL FIRE, Natural Resources Conservation System, private landowners, fallers, loggers, as well as private consulting foresters. And for the last month, we've been working on those very issues, and I want to share with you what we've come up with so far. Obviously, a fire of this magnitude, this fire is the exception to the rule. Okay, as we've heard all night, these kinds of fires don't happen very often. And it's across 70,000 acres. 70,000 acres of different kinds of soil types, different kinds of plant communities, as well as different steepness, different slopes, different aspects. And so there's not one answer that will fit everybody's situation. But in general, just to give you an appreciation for the magnitude of what we're dealing with, across 70,000 acres, if we just assume there's 100 trees per acre, and that number is woefully low, but 100 trees over 70,000 acres is 7 million trees. Chances are most of the Cobb Mountain had closer to 700 trees per acre. So we are talking about millions of trees that have been affected. Prior to the fire, as people have talked upon already, many of the trees were already stressed because of the enormity of the drought and the impact of an endemic outbreak of three species of bark beetles. So most of these trees, particularly the conifers, were already in extremely stressed condition before the fire ever hit. And so we're dealing with a culmination of two extraordinary events that have impacted this forest. One of the things I would suggest to all of you, depending on where you are and where your property is and the intensity of the fire that went across your property, I would suspect that this coming spring, if you've got any cones left on your trees, you know, the trees haven't been scorched completely, this spring you should start to see some baby ponderosa pine seedlings starting to emerge. They're going to be very small. They're going to be tiny. You're going to look down on them, they're going to be about the size of a quarter. They're going to look like little green stars coming out of the ground. So hopefully, some of the natural process following a fire, we will start to see some recovery. I'll give you three examples of recovery that I've just visited in the last 3 weeks. You remember the wildfire that hit Highway 20 just 3 years ago? As you're driving east to Colusa on the north side of the highway, you see that almost all of the oaks have resprouted. Oaks are incredibly resilient. So just because the top part of a tree has been burned off, that doesn't mean that the organism is dead. The root system is still alive. The good news is that root system is still holding soil in place. So the underground structures of the tree, regardless of how bad the above ground structure looks, is still going to be working in our behalf to try and hold soil in place. Conifers, it's a different story. Pine trees do not rebound from fire as quickly, or they just don't have the capacity to sprout as oaks do. The only North American conifer that can sprout is Coast Redwood. So pine trees won't sprout. Douglas fir trees won't sprout. Sugar pine trees won't sprout, and neither will incense cedar. So there are some areas that have been so badly scorched that chances are there will have to be physical planting of trees to try and recapture the forest. We have we've identified two sources of Cobb Mountain seed. I've got a group of folks that are very interested in helping us putting 500,000 seeds in containers ready for planting in 2017. We're working on it. It's a process. It's a process of finding the funders. It's a process of finding who's going to manage that program and how do we get the seeds out to folks that need them. And those seeds will be primarily ponderosa pine, sugar pine, and Douglas fir. So if this group of folks that I brought together, if we can, and we had a meeting at 10 o'clock this morning and everybody said, Greg, pull the trigger, hopefully in the next couple weeks, we'll get those seeds in containers either at the Placerville Nursery or a nursery up in Aetna in Siskiyou County. And in 2017, we'll have seedlings ready to plant. In the meantime, though, chances are some of you will see some recovery on its own of ponderosa pine, particularly. It's a prolific seed producer, and ironically, pines need bare mineral soil in order to generate and to germinate. Fires provide bare mineral soils. So as most plant species in California, the plant species on Cobb Mountain are fire adapted. People have talked about, you know, resprouting brush. That's a challenge in California. Most of our brush species, ceanothus, toyon, manzanita, they are dependent on fire in order to crack their hard seed coat to germinate. They are actually waiting for a fire to restart their life cycles again. And they are an aggressive species. And this spring, you will see a lot of brush species trying to capture the site. At some point, you're going to, on your own property, your own land, you know, you'll be able to decide, say, well, I don't want that much brush. And it's a lot easier to cut the brush when it's 6 inches high than when it's 6 feet high. So active engagement on your property, looking at these brush species coming back, maybe digging them out, cutting them under. If you choose to use herbicides, that's the way to go. If you choose to use goats, that's another way to manage this vegetation. But these plants will respond vigorously in the aftermath of a fire. That's how they're hardwired. They don't have a choice. As Supervisor Brown said, you will see more, you know, it's going to be an unusual sight on Cobb Mountain. We're going to be seeing logging trucks in the next year to 18 months, simply because these pine trees do not have a long shelf life when they've been exposed to fire. The wood will deteriorate very quickly. The beetles will, and there's two kinds of, bark beetles attack live wood. There are other beetles that attack dead wood, and they're big beetles, like flat-headed boar, nautilus beetle. Some of these grubs are the size of my pinky, and so they will cause deterioration very quickly. So for those landowners that wish to harvest their lumber or their trees, they're going to have to do it quickly. Something to remember, the state of California, timber harvest in California is dictated by the forest practice rules. A lot of rules. If you want to sell, barter, or trade your trees, even in a salvage operation, you'll need to work with Cal Fire and get an exemption permit. Usually that requires the use of a registered professional forester, somebody to go through, mark the trees, because as we've heard tonight, you don't want to slick off your property. There may be some merchantable trees that you can sell so you can get some money to buy some seedlings to put back on your property, because you're not going to make a lot of money. I'll tell you right now, you're not going to make a lot of money selling these trees, but you might be able to generate a little bit of income if you want to do some reforestation or other improvement, road improvement, or replacing culverts or something like that. The challenge we have in a lot of Lake County, or a lot of Cobb Mountain, is a lot of these parcels are very small. It's just not economically feasible to bring in a faller and a hauler and to haul these out. So talking with Supervisor Brown today, we're beginning just today, 3 o'clock, 3:30 this afternoon, these small lots, people that have 18 trees, is there a way that we can get some OES funding to come in, take your trees, you know, and get them off site, store them somewhere, and then figure out how to mill them later? People, it may be pie in the sky. Today in our discussion, people are interested, can we get a mill to come into Cobb Mountain so that we can mill and plane the lumber here so people can use their own wood to rebuild their homes or rebuild their barns? I mean, we know that this is at the core of what people want to see happen. Can we make it happen quickly enough is the sticking point. You know, can we find a portable mill? Can we bring it in? Can we set it up in a location with infrastructure that can run the mill? So we're having those kinds of discussions right now. We will continue to push on that because the challenge is in any kind of commercial venture, the numbers, it's really hard to make the numbers work with these species of trees. They're relatively low valued. The cost of transportation, it just blows it out of the water. The closest pine mill in Lake County is in Lincoln, which is on the other side of the state. Mendocino Redwood Company has offered a short window, maybe a year, maybe 18 months, where they will be purchasing salvage logs. But as I said, they can only take sound logs. They can't take beetle-ridden logs, but they can't make 2x4s out of them. So there may be an opportunity relatively close that, you know, we might be able to make something work. Again, dead standing trees have ecological value. Everybody in this room recognizes it. There are a lot of organisms that utilize dead standing trees, whether it's woodpeckers. Beetles play a role in the environment, right? So do other insects, and so do other organisms, including fungi. So the reason I'm bringing this up is because nobody's talking about slicking off anybody's property, because it's your property. Ultimately, it's your decision what you do or choose not to do. They're your trees. They're a resource, to the most part. Yeah, it's tough. It's tough listening to that. There are programs that can help. There's a program called the California Forest Improvement Program that's run through Cal Fire. In order to qualify for that money, those funds, you need to have a forest management plan, and you will need to use a registered professional forester to develop that plan. Obviously, that's not going to work for somebody that has a quarter of an acre or a half an acre. Korinn talked about the natural resources conservation programs called the EQIP program, Environmental Quality Improvement Program?
Incentives
program. You don't need a special permit for that. You just need to talk to Korinn to talk about what funds may be available for replanting, erosion control, and the like, even wildlife improvement. So I think, you know, what we will see, well, that's what I wanted to share with you. So as I said, the wildfire driving along Highway 20, you can see the forest trying to rebound. I visited the Ponderosa fire earlier last week in western Shasta County. That was a fire it was an anomaly like this fire. The fire was 5 years ago now. The ponderosa pines that have been planted are about 3 feet tall. The oak trees are about 7 or 8 feet tall. I visited the Round Mountain fire in east of Shasta County a month ago. That fire occurred in 1992. The pine trees are starting to look like pine trees. They're 20 feet tall. The oak trees are starting to look like oak trees. They're looking less like bushes. And we know those trees, I drove through that day when that fire started. I know when it started, and I know it's 22 years ago. So in forestry, we talk about the value of time. We talk about time marching on. And you know, there's an old Chinese proverb that says, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The best time to plant a tree is today. We're working on getting trees available for people to plant trees in the very near future. One thing I will offer, again, you know, I'm it, just like everyone else has said. Something I've done up here in Cobb Mountain, and I've done in Lake County a lot, I do neighborhood walkabouts. And if you want me to come out to your property, what I'll ask is, get your neighbors together. And we'll go walking around. And I'll explain to you the matrix in my head, the criteria of which tree stays, which tree goes, which tree can I wait. You know, so rather than me coming and talking to you individually, the last one we did, Master Gardeners and others, had about 40 people. I looked like the Pied Piper walking down the road, right, and all these people. But we had a great time in terms of exchanging information and really, you know, when you're in a room like this, it's hard to talk about which tree do I take, which one do I leave. We can go on the ground, get your neighbors together, we'll go out on the ground, we'll do a walkabout in your neighborhood, I'll have my blue paint. And you can see my blue paint. I only use blue paint.
Can we have your name and phone number?
First name is Greg. Last name is spelled G-I-U-S-T-I, Giusti. In Lakeport, my office is 263-6838. And while you're writing everything down, I've got cards here. I've got a stack of cards. But the University of California site here in Lake County, our webpage is CE Lake. .ucanr.edu. We've got a full page on dealing with post-fire recovery of not only forest issues, but also if you want to rebuild a house, you know, not that it would have made a big difference in this fire, but there are ways to build your house more fire safe. And to, I don't want to use fireproof, but there are things that you can do, and I encourage you to explore options when you're talking with your contractor to find out what kind of architectural structures are less capable of catching fire or catching heat. Those are important things. So again, you know, like all of us, we're part of this community. We're here to work with you and work through this process of forest recovery. And I'll take a couple of questions, Larry.
Greg, can you briefly explain to us, Boggs Forest, Demonstration Forest, was has been groomed for years to show us that it won't burn down if a fire comes.
Yeah, I sent people there to show them what a fireproof forest looks like.
So what happened?
What happened? You know how many people have asked me what worked in this fire? Nothing worked. We had 4 or 5% humidity, it was 105 degrees, we had a 40 mile an hour wind, and we had a lot of fuel. It was the perfect storm.
4 years of drought.
And 4 years of drought and fall when leaves are naturally drying out on top of it. It was just an anomaly. I don't know how else to say it. The ferocity of this fire was unprecedented. Yes, sir.
Ironically, about a week before the fire, there were a number of articles about Mediterranean cypresses and how they are fire resistant. If you look back in the early 2000s, the research said, no, Europe is creating forests with these in them. What is your opinion?
The opinion is whether certain Mediterranean cypress are more fire resistant or others. I had a book show up in my office today, and I actually ordered it. It was written by Harold Biswell, the preeminent fire ecologist for the University of California from the 30s through the early 60s. He did most of his research at Hoburg's. And he talked extensively about the role of prescribed fire or control fire, which absolutely is a means of managing fuels. In many cases today, even though as an ecologist, I would be the first one to espouse the values of control burning just because of California's Mediterranean ecological system. But we can't use prescribed fire in every place every day, but we need to manage fuels, whether it's through machines, whether it's through goats, or whether it's through hand loppers. Somehow, you know, we have to get serious in the state of California to look at how do we actively manage fuels to do the best we can, because obviously in this fire, Boggs Mountain was the place I sent people to show them how to fireproof their properties. And that fire just swept through that acreage. So again, it's all we can do is our best. Yes. Yes.
I kind of had a comment and a question.
Sure.
First off, we're talking here about what we're going to do to deal with the fuels that you're talking about, goats, hand cutting. But in reality, a lot of people use herbicides. And is this going to be something that we are going to have to now deal with as a community, that people are going to, and other people that are dealing with these properties are going to be using these herbicides to control these fuels? And that being said, we have to look at the sensitivity of where we live. We're the Mayacama Mountains here. This is the watershed for not only six creeks, our headwaters right here in this land. And they flow all the way down to Solana Lake, which gives the water to Vacaville and places like that. So when we talk about using these herbicides, and we talk about fuel reduction, and we talk about people taking down huge trees around these watersheds, what do we have to look at as far as an agency that is going to kind of keep the checks and balances
right
of that watershed intact?
So the question is sensitivity to herbicides and monitoring. You know, for 35 years, I've worked in forestry, and a lot of that was in Mendocino County. There is no greater hot button issue in forestry than herbicide use. It's a personal choice, and it is a very emotional topic. If one was to use chemicals to control plants, I would always suggest that you do it when the plant is as small as possible. You want to use the least amount of material you possibly can get away with. So spraying a plant this size, drop, versus a plant that you've allowed to get 6 feet tall and you have to spray like this, you're using a lot of volume. So one of the approaches is how do you minimize volume? How do you reduce risk for the applicator as well as the environment? So when I talked about a process, all plants are easier to deal with when they're small. So if we're dealing with natural regeneration of pines and you have a property and this spring you've got a carpet of ponderosa pines, well, it's a lot easier to start thinning them, you know, and spreading them out. And then in 3 years you go back and you thin them out again. And in 5 years you go and thin them out again. So the more activity, the more attention you give to little plants, not only is it easier to deal with, but if you choose to use a chemical, you're using far less.
That's but in this case, it's happening right before winter, so we don't want that stuff pouring down
right.
these mudslides.
You wouldn't do it now.
This creek.
No, you would not do it now. The plants are shutting down, so you're talking about late spring, early summer, if, and again, it's a personal choice, if you choose to use them. But no, now's not the time to do any of that. Now's the time to button up your soils. Well, one thing I wanted to mention, if you have culverts on your property, make sure your culverts are clear, right? They're designed to move water, and they increase velocity of water because they usually shrink the area that the water is moving through. A real good way to, once you clean out your culvert, get a T-post, a metal fence post, or two of them, and put them on the upside. Pour, you know, just stick them in the ground so that if any debris, any branches or anything, that'll catch it before it gets to the mouth of the culvert. And then it's easier to clean, too. So before the first rains, check your culverts. Immediately after the first significant rain, check your culverts, because that's where we're going to get most erosive impact. You know, big time erosive impact is in these culverts that are increasing the velocity of the water. In the back, sir, you had your question. So the question is, how do you get involved?
Yeah, and also that I have examples of a lot of things that are not maybe native here, as well as native here, but things that are native nearby or in California.
Yeah. Well, I've been getting a lot of questions. The question is, you know, I've got trees, I want to plant them, maybe you want to share them with people. Some are native, some are not. I've been, you know, somebody asked me, well, can I plant a Colorado blue spruce? Well, sure, it's one tree in 70,000 acres. Yeah, you know, but if you plant a palm tree, I'm not coming to your place. I'm just telling you. I'm just throwing it out there so you know. But again, think of the scale that we're trying to do. So if you've got some trees that obviously, you know, as an ecologist, I always want to see native plants first. But if people want to reestablish trees around their house and they want to plant a half a dozen trees, plant them. Absolutely. Yes, sir.
Okay, I've got a lot of trees on my place. They cut down oaks, they cut down everything.
Yes, sir.
I'm up on Gifford. Now, a lot of these are big, and there's a lot of timber in them, and I need to know, who can we talk to about selling this timber?
How many acres or how many trees?
How many trees? Oh, there's probably two dozen.
Yeah, that's the challenge. That's not going to be enough. You're going to lose a lot of money if you want to move those trees. So one of the things that I'm talking about with the supervisors, how do we take your 24 trees? How do we take your 60 trees? How do we take your 20 trees? How can we put them together to get a critical mass that'll help pay for these few number of trees? I don't have an answer for you, but that's one of the challenges that we're wrestling with.
I mean, this stuff's going to have to move pretty quick.
We would like to move it pretty quick, yes.
We've got a lot of big timber up there.
Yes, sir.
And they cut down everything. They leave with the back of the lot and cut every damn thing down. Now, rather than give that to somebody when it didn't need to be cut down, they cut the oaks too. They cut everything. So I'm kind of pissed at that.
And I can
I'm
tell.
Thinking, well, I'm not just going to let somebody walk off with all that timber. That
right.
was the reason why I lived there.
Did you get my phone number when you?
No, I didn't.
Check with me before we leave, and I'll.
But that is, you know. So again,
let me
give you an example, and Danny, hold my feet to the fire on this, or Jim, or someone that does this for a living. But you know, these trees, maybe I'll just use round numbers. Maybe you can get $400. 1,000 board feet for the kind of trees that are up here, okay? One logging truck holds about 5,000 board feet, give or take. So you have a $400 you get for selling 1,000 board feet of these whitewoods. The logging costs are $230 to $250 a thousand, and then the trucking costs are $135 to $150 a thousand. So you don't make any money. You know, you're just not going to make any money. These trees just don't have the kind of value when you talk about the machinery and the personnel to move these big organisms, put them on a truck, and move them somewhere. So that's
valuable to somebody.
Pardon me?
They're valuable to somebody.
Well, I was just talking about economic value. Trees have lots of values, absolutely.
Yeah, economically valuable to somebody.
Right. We just have to figure out if how. Now, individually, there's people on Cobb Mountain that have little wood misers, little portable mills. you know, if you wanted to mill that lumber up, maybe you guys in the audience know who's speaking here. Maybe you can approach him after. So, you know, if you can, there's people up here that have little wood misers. They can bring the mill to your place. They can cut it, rough cut it into in dimensional wood, and you can stack it, protect it from the environment, and decide what to do with it later. That is an option. Yes, sir.
Do these bark beetles have a preference for, or do they have a desire for Douglas fir?
The question is, do bark beetles have a preferential treatment? The short answer is yes. The beetles that are attacking pines are not the beetles attacking fir. So there's different species. They're in the same family a lot of times, but they are different. They work the same way. They look a lot the same, but they're flying around and they're selecting. They're preferentially selecting the tree species that they're interested in, yes.
Oh, so planting Douglas fir isn't going to mitigate this beetle problem.
So the question is, planting Douglas fir going to mitigate the beetle problem? That's not a reason not to plant them. Again, these trees that are being attacked by beetles, you know, they've been here for a long time. Hopefully, this drought cycle will end someday. And what happens, real quick, and I'm going to just, the way it works is that, you know, trees produce sap, resin. The resin is moving through the phloem and the xylem that Jim was talking about, the cambial layer. When a beetle bores in on a vigorous tree, that sap or that resin pushes the beetle out. All right, so that's what happens. It physically pushes the beetle outside of the bark. When trees are water stressed, their resin flows, their sap flows are reduced. They don't have the pressure to push the beetle out. So once you get a beetle started and it creates a cavity, if you will, a dead spot in the tree, well, the tree is further stressed. Obviously, it's not one beetle at a time. You may have 1,000 beetles at a time, and each time one of those beetles gets a foothold, the tree gets progressively more and more stressed, and you get this downward spiral. So, as I think Jim said, there's always beetles out here. There's always beetles in trees. The conditions, again, another perfect storm, is that there simply isn't enough resin in these trees so they can defend themselves. Sir, in the back.
You have dead burned trees in your own private line. Can we just have those fallen and not have to do with a harvest permit?
If you don't sell, barter, or trade, there's no money involved or no perception of money, they're your trees, you can do what you want.
Can I say one thing about that?
And Jim can confirm this, but on the lots that are 1 acre and small, actually, I guess all size lots that are small, this is going to be a case by case. They're going to be working with people. So if you do have wood on there that you think you can sell or barter or trade, there's probably going to be an option available for you. You don't have to go through this big giant harvest plan and all that on the smaller lots.
Yes.
I think here there's importance of leaving dead trees standing up for the purpose of ecology and animals.
Absolutely.
So
the question
you
is,
have to cut them down, you shouldn't.
Right. No, the question is, you know,
unless they're hazard trees.
Right, so if you've got 40 acres, and in the back 40 you've got dead standing trees and you want to leave them, absolutely, leave them. Just don't put a picnic table under them, because the only thing a dead tree has left to do is fall over.
And if I may ask
yes.
another question, can you talk about how the trees fall? I was told that pine trees don't typically do this because of the root system, whereas oaks will drop off.
Yeah, well, you know, so again, if a tree is on a slope, gravity is going to pull it in that direction. If we've got a strong, and as the wood degrades, as the quality of the wood degrades over time, it may start breaking off in pieces. In a strong wood, in a strong wind, the top third might fall out, and then you'll have this standing snag. Again, very important for a number of wildlife species. Lean in the tree, lean on the soil. A straight up and down tree could break in pieces, or eventually, when the roots rot, the wind could simply push it over. And so, all of the above. Yeah, there's no one answer for that. Yes, sir.
Maybe you or Jim could answer this. What's the plan for Vox?
We're going to harvest as many of the dead
there you
trees.
Go. There you go. The question is, what's the plan for Vox State Forest?
We're going to try and harvest as many dead trees as the market will absorb. We're also planning on leaving a percentage, I don't know if you remember what Nick said it was, 5 to 10% of the trees will actually be left in small patches that add wildlife value. So, and we're going to look for trees that are persistent, not the ponderosa pine that tends to fall over in 3 or 4 years, but perhaps sugar pine or Doug fir that'll stand there for quite a while. We're going to leave groups of those scattered across the forest, you know, looking for ideal spots, the best thing for wildlife, something, maybe something near water or canyons or whatever, where they're not a hazard to the trails. But other than that, we're going to try and get as much of that dead timber out of there for public safety and not to waste it.
Any projection about when people will be able to go in there again?
You know, I don't know if there's any plans yet. They got to get the logging going underway, and perhaps if they finish an area, perhaps they may open it, but it's a little too soon to tell.
Yes. I have a quick question. I hear trees and I hear years. I have a lot of land that's going to get washed away. Down in Middletown, there are 50-pound bags of seed. Is that something I get scattered around, or is that something I don't do?
That's one of the greatest controversies in fire ecology.
Repeat.
So the question is, there's people offering seed, there's bags of seed, whether it's sterile barley, whether it's sterile annual ryegrass, or just grass seed. One of the challenges with seeding is if you throw seeds out and we get a substantial amount of rain, well, the seed just moves with the ash and everything, right? I mean, what does the grass will provide erosion protection when it's grass, not a seed. And so if you put it on any kind of a slope and we get a substantial rain, it just moves down. And then through the summer, we've got really, you know, nice green ditches along the side of the road. So generally speaking, my personal preference is that if you have some flat ground and you know it's not going to go anywhere and you want to put seed there, it's probably not going to be an erosion issue anyway. But if you need to see some green, that would be where to spend that money. Putting it on a slope is probably going to move. Probably seen, I've had a lot of comments in the media talking about if you have down trees, if you have down branches, you know, any kind of structure is very important for minimizing and trapping surface erosion. Fortunately, you know, we don't have arroyos in Lake County like San Diego County, and hopefully we won't get 3 inches of rain in 30 minutes. I mean, that was an equally unusual event with those mudslides they had this week. But we will see a lot of surface movement of soil and ash. So any kind of physical structure that's on the ground, branches, twigs, logs, you know, things like that, straw bales, anything like that can slow that down and trap it and try and hold it in place. Ideally, you know, we'd like a couple of half-inch events coming through and kind of pack everything down and let things grow. It's amazing. I drove up the bogs today. Jim and I had a meeting up there, and there's already bracken fern popping up through the ash. You know, so things want to grow, but the seed is. I'm not saying don't do it, but just recognize that some places you're just putting out seed, and that seed itself has no properties to hold soil in place.
You feel the urge to throw seed.
Oh no, you want to do that? Yeah.
Nature reseeds herself.
Yeah, well,
she
certainly.
Knows how to put seeds out better than we do.
Yeah, if you want to throw seeds, I'd throw out California poppy or something so you have some color. Yes.
I think one of the challenges that a lot of people I know have had with this incident is that we haven't gotten the information about it until now. And so the devastation of the fire has the reaction and the response as far as, you know, clear cutting certain areas has been even more devastating to the community at large. And I'm just wondering, in the case of bogs, if there's any way before that just gets clear cut, if the community can actually have a meaningful
public comment.
Well, I don't know about public comment, but at least to get into the forest, mourn the loss of it as having been burnt by the fire versus the clear cut that it's going to become. I think we all know that that's happening. But it's traumatic, very traumatic to just, I'm maybe just speaking for myself, but I don't think so.
Did everybody hear a comment? Okay, she's wondering about a meeting in the forest for people that, let me put it bluntly, to say goodbye to the forest. I don't know if that's out of the question. I can certainly bring it up to the new forest manager, Nick. I thought he was going to be here tonight.
I'm right here.
Oh, I'm sorry. Come on up, Nick. Did you hear the question?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll let Nick address it. Nick's the forest manager, started this year.
Yeah, I think the issue with bogs is it's really unsafe out there right now. There's
We lost about 80% of the trees to the fire. We're saving every green tree we possibly can. And we got teams of foresters out marking leaf trees. And but the problem is all the dead trees, like you can't go out there without a hard hat. Even with a hard hat, that's not gonna protect you if something big comes down. And so that's definitely a request that I understand that we're grappling with, you know, to get how to get people out there. And
I mean,
it's just,
even if it's just in the parking lot where the community can come together and mourn, because the parking lot is still green. That area.
Yeah, we definitely want to try to work with the community. We're going to have some Friends of Boggs. We're working with Friends of Boggs to have like an outreach meeting, and this is really, this meeting is more geared towards, you know, the trees on people's properties, but we want to have a meeting to talk about bogs and what we got in store and, you know, what our options are.
Do you have a sign-up list for the people that would be interested in attending that meeting?
I think Friends of Boggs is a really good conduit, and then our website, Cal Fire's website on bogs, we'll put something on there.
Just one last point I want to talk. Thank you
very much. I wanted, very quickly, there will be, one of the things we worked out today is we will have probably in the first 2 weeks of November a public workshop focusing strictly on forests and forestry, reforestation. Obviously, we'll get the word out. One of the people I want to bring up, and we're sharing him with the Butte Fire, who's having similar meetings like this, but his name is Larry Camp. And he's a retired forester, RPF, who spent his life working for the Internal Revenue Service. And so there's nobody that knows tax law and forest tax law and how you can claim loss on your property better than him. And he's one of the resources I want to bring to Lake County so people can you know, talk to a real expert on the economics of forest recovery and how you might get some tax relief from some of this. So he's one of the people that's on my list. Yes, sir. I like the way you're jumping.
Thank you. So I would like to go back to something that you said earlier. It doesn't involve specific trees, as I know the topic is. It does involve trees in general, but I live in Anderson Springs, or I should say I lived in Anderson Springs. And everybody knows the devastation is everywhere. But as far as Anderson Springs goes, the view that I used to have was of Cobb to the north, I think Davies' property to the south, and then whatever we call Harbin over to the left, and then a valley that ran up to the geysers. It was surrounded by forest. The forest is gone. Now, in regards to the Davies' property, it's private. I think a lot of Cobb's in that area is also private. I would think that a lot of the Harbin property as it comes over the ridge is private. And so when I try to envision, and believe me, I've lived here longer than that bald-headed guy that's leaving the room. And, and I remember very much. Yeah. Thanks, Rob. I remember the drought of 74, 75, 76, and the beetles that just came in and just killed us like crazy, and we lost ponderosas. And those ponderosas, although they could come back, they did not come back. There was just no reason for them to come back. So my concern is, although it's possible that the trees could come back in the areas I'm talking about, I'm not talking about bog forest, I'm not talking about cob forest, I'm talking about private property. What, in your opinion, will I tell my grandchildren that's going to look like if I rebuild my two-story home that was designed to look at those views?
In forestry,
give me your 30-year crystal ball.
In forestry, I always tell people, if you plant trees today, you're planting them for your grandchildren.
Yeah, I'm fine with that, but you understand that what I'm asking is, I'm looking at private property.
So each
is really under no obligation to plant anything at all.
You're right, and that's California state law does not require people to replant after a fire. It is a personal choice. There will be natural regeneration, unless, you know, there's an area that's just totally scorched and there are no cones hanging on the tree. hopefully, I know that, well, I don't know about Harbin's. I know Hobart's, for example, is working with a forester. Those private landowners hopefully will reach out to a forester and get a plan written, and we'll start putting some trees in the ground.
Harbin is
working with an RPS. Yes?
I'm in the middle of the Springs Road, and all the property across the street from me has all been burned, and I have gone across the street and walked down to the creek, and the trees are coming back.
Yeah, so the question, somebody just made an observation that some of the trees coming back. Absolutely, some trees will come back. It's hard on pines. When you know, pine trees, when they're needles.
But they're little ponderosas.
Yeah, and so I fully expect this spring people to go out and survey your property, and you will see these little green stars starting to pop out of the ash, and the forest will start to move in that direction again. Yes?
Two questions. Water, like a watershed or waterway on our property, are those waterways going to be a priority opposed to, I'm not saying my property is more important than anyone else's, but we definitely have a major seasonal creek that flows through our way, and just the little bit of rain we've had to see the rubble start to move and shift already is scary.
Where's Korinn?
Right here.
We actually had a team of folks out there evaluating for life hazards for land. You mentioned that, correct?
No.
Okay, we didn't talk about it. Korinn was part of a team that involved Cal Fire, Department of Mines and Geology, NRCS, etc. And they looked at the fire, basically how severe the fire burned and where it burned. The most intense, that we have GIS mapping of fire intensity. So those areas that are prone to landslides or other things that would cause possible human life, loss to life, they looked at very carefully. And they're, I'm going to go ahead and let you speak to this because it was your team.
So you identified approximately 120 sites. That does not mean in, you know, some of those sites included multiple houses, you know, things like that. We identified 120 sites that are put on a list. The report is available. Actually, if you go to the Valley Fire incident on the Cal Fire website, you can get a copy of the report and see what those sites were.
And I'm worried about the contamination of the creek from the debris not being able to be moved fast enough.
What area are you in?
Was I in?
Well, the address of the property.
It's on Belize. And we have that creek has been, while we've been there, even like a rain, good rain, we've seen it get up to, you know, 5 feet real fast. And it's seasonal and it goes underground and feeds Cold Creek.
Yeah, I know this wasn't part of the meeting, but just you could probably talk to Jeff.
Well, because that area hasn't been touched for the trees, and you guys are saying like the faster the trees move, the faster the debris moves, but that
they have a schedule that we're going by on them, and we're trying to get the trees out before them. They're not waiting for us right now to move the trees, and we're hoping that doesn't get to that point. We don't want them to be waiting for us, but he could probably tell you better offline what the schedule is for your area.
I'm just worried about the water.
Sure, of course,
the land's
yeah.
We all are.
We're all worried about the water. We know the streams are going to be impacted. There's not a lot we're going to be able to do with it. One thing is, how intense is the first few rains going to be? If we get a major storm in here that dumps 4 or 5 inches all at once in a 12-hour period, we're in trouble. If we get a half inch at a time for you know, through November, and things start to firm up a little bit, I don't want to get sidetracked, but you know, the soil's really not going to absorb the water right now. It's kind of hydrophobic. It repels the water, and that's going to last for a year, up to a year. So we need those gentle rains to break down that hydrophobic layer to allow the water to penetrate. So we don't know what El Nino is going to bring yet. I mean, it's anybody's guess, but we are planning for the worst case scenario with her team looking at the life hazards. But we can't address every hazard that's out there. It is going to impact the water course. We know the water's going to go into Lake Berryessa. There are water supply issues down there. It's going to go into Clear Lake. There is going to be mud in the streams. We know that.
Are there any hotspots left, or are you going to have most of them locked up?
Oh, we had one yesterday. And you're gonna, and we're gonna keep on putting those hot spots out. Keep reporting them. If you see them, we want to know where they're at. We're gonna go after and get them and put them out. Well, the helicopter's doing a lot of training. We're training a lot of new firefighters up there. We're training them to do rescues. So you're gonna hear a lot of activity. It doesn't necessarily mean they're going to put out a smoke. But yesterday there was over towards High Valley Road. There was a smoke that we had to go put out. And we're going to keep putting them out. So if you see something and it bothers, just let us know.
Yeah. How much more do we have on the agenda? What else are we really going to cover?
I think, you know, unless we have questions
are
about the trees.
Yeah. That are coming on, or,
what's that?
I mean, is there anyone else scheduled?
No. Okay, so. No, we're doing questions now. So, okay. Gabriella.
Our water is above the Giffords. It's mostly ponderosa and dogwood. And specifically, I have a really beautiful sugar pine I'm hoping makes it. And last week when I went up, she had dropped all her cones. And I'm wondering if that says anything about the viability of the tree, or is that just a natural reaction to the fire? She still is pretty green on her crown.
Well, if the cones are open, you know, that means those seeds were shed, and that's why trees produce seed, is to carry on their progeny, their genetic components. If the cones fell and they were still tight, green cones, then that tree hasn't released them. But if they're open, you know, nice big open cones, then those cones have done their job.
And they're not
burned. Right. And well, you know, a lot of pines, that dry fire actually forces those bracts on those cones to open up, and they'll shoot those seeds out. So what I would do is this coming spring, regardless if the maternal tree is alive or not, you know, start looking around the base, and you'll probably see some progeny coming up. Okay. Yes.
Yeah, I have a question for Cobb, actually. A lot of the properties that, you know, actually border Boggs Forest, so, and there's a lot of dead trees that come right up to the properties. Is there going to be some priority placed on those trees that are bordering residences as far as the cleanup?
Yeah, those are high priority. We're going to try to get in there in the next couple of weeks and start cutting those down. Anything that is dead that could hit a lot is a top priority.
Yeah, we certainly want them cut before you start building. Kim?
Thanks for clarification on the seeding. Another issue that doesn't seem to have clear answers is the fallen logs can be used for helping to prevent slides, but they can also be at risk for log jamming. Can you speak a little bit about, or is this a good resource people can use?
Well, if a tree's been felled and cut into segments, it's more likely to roll and end up in a water course. If it's in that position, it has to be near, you know, on a hillside or something. A full tree-length tree is tend to going to roll up against other trees. Usually you're not going to see a full-length tree get into a water course unless it was directionally felled into the water course. So for the most part, most of these trees aren't just going to fall down this winter. They're sound trees. They just died, so they haven't started to deteriorate. They're probably not going into the water course unless there was some defect. So that's, to me, is not a big concern yet. Over the years, as those pine trees break apart from rot, they are going to start breaking up in segments, and those segments can end up in the water course. Barbara.
I just wanted to kind of give a report on the free trees that are coming in from Oregon. I talked to the nursery today, and 500 specimen Colorado blue spruce. All we have to do is raise enough money to ship them, which averages $25 a tree, and these are 10, 12 foot Colorado blue spruce. They're $500 each tree. So I'm working on that. Also, he said there's a lot of Douglas fir farms where he is, and the Douglas fir people have oversized trees that they want to get rid of because they want to plant small Christmas trees. And he said that if we could get somebody up there to help digging them up and transporting them, that we could have as many of those Douglas fir trees. And again, we're talking medium-sized trees. So, anyway, that's what I'm working on.
Thank you, Barbara.
Thanks, Barbara. I think in the back, back there was next.
And they said it's more hazardous than it was prior to fires, because now all the vegetation didn't crowd up mostly. Most of the trees, survived. But it's, you know, 5 acres.
I understand dirty burn.
Yeah, okay. Is there going to be any resources available
On private land, no. If you didn't hear his question, he had what he called a dirty burn. That's where the fire goes through at a cooler temperature. It basically kills the brush but doesn't take the leaves off, or it doesn't cause the needles to burn off your tree. So now everything's dry, it's still in place, and it can reburn under the right conditions. And if you've noticed, a lot of needles are falling right now, a lot of leaves are falling, your roofs are getting covered with leaves and needles. We're not out of fire season yet. I know this is a time of year that you want to clean your gutters for rain and stuff, but clean it for fire protection too. You usually don't think about it this time of year. We're at the end of fire season, but we're still in fire season. There's still that possibility. But as far as answering your questions, I'm not aware of any program that would pay except for, oh, Korinn has some.
Well, back to the programs that NRCS has available. The gal sitting right next to you has the list, so put your name on there.
Let me throw one more thing out there. When we talked about identifying trees, whether they needed to be cut or not, one thing I failed to mention, and when Caltrans was up speaking, it reminded me, trees tend to grow up in stands. And if you have one tree in the middle of a tight stand of trees that might be green, but everything around is dead, and you cut all those dead trees down, you leave that one wispy, tall pine tree up there exposed to the wind, which it's never been exposed to the wind before. It may, or is most likely, going to be a hazard to wind throw or coming down. And so in that's a case where somebody may cut a green tree that is a hazard, but it wasn't necessarily burned to the point where it needed to be cut. So I just want to bring that up.
To what you're saying, I'm sure there are lots of situations like that. But I live on a property that wasn't burned, and there were a lot of trees that were marked. And I talked to a lot of people that have experiences like this gentleman. The trees that were marked were green. Later, somebody came back and blacked over the X's. They said, oh, we were a bit eager, overzealous. It was obvious, I would say, to everybody in this room that these trees were alive. I have the thing that I take issue with, and this is with PG&E. In 2011, when we had the snowstorm, ponderosa pine snapped in half, right on the street, 4 feet from the line. The next summer, the tree was absolutely dead. No four branches, brown needles. I called them several times, and they finally came out a few weeks ago to cut this down. The neighbor lot had a ponderosa pine that was as big as any that you can imagine, 4 feet across. It was completely white. It was there for years, and it would have taken out the house across the street, the road, the lines. They just took it out a few weeks before the fire. So I understand in a way that, you know, there's a lot of emphasis on protecting the lines and the roads. But to me, and I think I speak for a few people here and who aren't here, it makes me angry to that hypocrisy of leaving trees for years that were dead and then going after trees that were obviously alive. And as I said, they did come back and black out the X's on the trees. But anybody here knows they would have lived. And I just like to see more. I hear the credentials that you talk about, the arborist, but there are some people out there that are obviously not doing the job.
Thank you. Steve?
Now, really, this is a question to the group.
and I'm not sure really this is a question that's been answered. How many people here are here because they feel a great many trees were cut unnecessarily by people that weren't necessarily qualified?
Big time.
I think really there's a feeling, a lot of people have had like have a discussion with PG&E about what the qualifications were. And the other question would be, what was their authority to go far deeply into people's property to cut trees, many of which weren't even burned? I think that is widespread.
That concern is widespread in the people that are just in this room. We heard a lot of that, and that was the impetus for having the meeting. We would have had it sooner, but this is the first day the school could be here. But I'm with you. Jim and I drove around, and we looked at trees, and you know, I'm just a regular guy. He's the expert, and he said that's probably a tree that should have been cut down. We don't know what the criteria was because we haven't talked to whoever it was that cut down, we want to get to the bottom of it. But we think, I know we can't bring the trees back that are cut down, but we think by putting some spotlight on this, that we slowed it down at least to a point where we can hold people accountable a little bit more. So I'm not disagreeing with you at all. So.
Can we confirm if PG&E has a prescriptive easement, as say Caltrans does? Because we had a number of trees that were nowhere near what we understood to
well,
be
the PG&E. What I would suggest that you do is contact PG&E directly.
I've done that and got around about quite a few times.
They're here tonight, so catch them while they're here. Yes, sir. Okay, I'm sorry. Hold on one second. We're almost done. And those of you that are leaving, that have to leave, thank you so much for coming. Appreciate it. You know, this is not going to be the last community meeting we have, I can assure you. Yes, right here.
Some near the electric and phone lines, but some not close here at all. So is that PG&E or is that AT&T?
I would call both of them till you find out.
Yeah.
The question was, I'm sorry. I know better than that too. The question was, there are yellow X's on trees that still are standing, and he wants to know if that's PG&E or AT&T and find out what the fate is of those trees, what's going on with the X's. And I suggested that he contact both of them to get to the bottom of it to find out. And if you still don't get anything, let me know, give me a call, my phone number. I gave my phone number out, it's on the website. We'll get to the bottom of it.
Also, is there any issue of just covering it over with black paint?
I can't tell you to do that. I don't know what the purpose of it is, just ma'am.
This gentleman over here earlier mentioned fuel management, and I'm just curious as to where there's anything you would be organizing the county to take care of, or to do some type of fuel management in areas that have been burned, just as kind of a preventative
So the same programs that can help you with reforestation can potentially help the private landowners with
public land,
or not public necessarily, but just like driving areas that aren't.
Oh, you're talking about, I thought you were talking about on your own property, I'm sorry.
No, I'm
okay, well, if it's county roads, then the county road needs to deal with it. If it's Caltrans, then Caltrans needs to deal with it. And Fire Safe Council is actually working on a few things on Rockin' and Rivieras and some other areas they're looking at as well. Okay, we'll stand by because we've got a program that we'll be having a meeting out there here real soon in the next couple of weeks. So
we are doing stuff on field break skills.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, yes, ma'am.
I think it's been wonderful. I've learned a lot from every agency, but I think that a lot of us have problems with one agency, and that's PG&E. And so how do we make sure? I mean, I can call their 800 number, and I can leave a message, and nothing happens. So as a community, how do we get everybody together to say, hey, this is the one agency that's not responding?
Well, I can't speak for PG&E, but I can tell you that I'm in constant communication with them over some issues that we just need to work out. I can't speak for them. The question is, with everything that's going on, there seems to be more issues with PG&E than any other agency, all of them combined. How do we deal with that with PG&E?
Yeah. So we have a infrastructure. Why don't you come up?
Sure. Yeah, so we have a customer infrastructure in place. Actually, Linda. Linda, can you raise your hand? Can you raise your hand? Linda here, she's going to help us out with any customer situations. I've got a number of flyers.
Speak into the microphone, please.
Will do. So what was the question? I'm sorry.
How long have you been with
PG&E?
Actually, I've been with PG&E 2.5 years.
Microphone.
2.5 years with PG&E, some of it in the claims department, and the rest of it with customer impact, which is the questions I've been answering.
So Linda's office line is on this flyer.
707-577-7218.
If there's questions and you need someone to come to your property, call this number. Linda will contact one of the arborists that we have in the field here, and they'll come out and they'll assess whether the trees with the yellow X's are for us or not.
Will they recheck the trees that are down already that they didn't check before they cut down?
So let me just stress that we're not here to cut down green trees that weren't affected by the fire. We don't want to cut any trees that more than.
That's the reality of what happened, and we need to take a leap to that because people want answers about why that happened.
30 trees on my property, 23 of them were cut down. Why they left the 6 or 7 left, I have no idea. They range from 38 inches, majority of them above 20 inches. 11179 on different springs between Mapes and Summit Drive, and check it out.
No, I would love to schedule an appointment to come actually to all the various properties to look at it.
Rather than one at a time. I think PG&E should meet with the citizens of Cobb about the issue, not deal with us. One
person
at a time.
Like somebody went through goofy with a chainsaw.
Well, I don't.
Really?
I don't know how to address all without seeing the tree.
No.
If there was a hazard or not, if that's impossible for me to determine here. I can tell you that the risk is different for what we're looking at versus a tree in the middle of box forest, right? When you're determining risk, you're looking at impact and frequency, right? So, you know, what is the likelihood of it to happen versus if it does happen, what the impact is. And the impact, unfortunately, in hitting a power line.
The impact, the guy with a chainsaw. I mean, they could have let those trees here. They could have took them down next year. Let them see out.
What one at a time, please?
You still have a problem in your organization where people within your organization and the fallers who are working for you do not agree on what your coding system is. So there are trees that are marked on my property with a spot, and the person who marked it told me that they're going to live that tree, and yet the fallers don't know that.
Okay, I'm going to make a suggestion here, and I'm not trying to cut you short or anything. Hold on one second. Hold on. We're going to get all the questions answered, except for those from PG&E, and then we're going to have, you guys are going to be able to talk to PG&E, if that's okay.
That's perfect.
Okay? Because I want to get these other questions answered, we get on, and then PG&E can... They can stay here and work with you folks that have specific questions on PG&E, if that'll work.
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay. Yes, sir.
There are a lot of trees being cut. They're all going to be logged out of here. Where's that? Who gets the money?
Well, see, that's what Greg was trying to explain to you. It all depends on, you know, if, you know, first of all, nobody's going to get any money.
Okay, I just wondered, yeah. Because if you, a lot of trees.
Yeah, there's no money. The market was horrible before the fire. It's just been absolutely saturated, and you know the best that we can hope for is maybe to pay for some of the removal off the lots, because that's all that we're interested in. I'm not interested in making any money. The county's not interested in making any money, and PG, nobody's interested in making any money and get rid of these lots. So, Kim?
I'm very interested in the work that you're doing, Korinn, because for me, I'm really interested in trying to protect people's well-being. And because what's happened with the fire event, we have very increased risk of flood and mudslide, and certain homes do not have any insurance coverage for those events right now. I have a map here that I got from FEMA,
Will you be available after this?
Yeah, I'm canceling my other.
Okay, so you'll be available once that happens.
Right here.
Any other? Yeah. Okay, thank you, Kim. Any other tree questions? Yes, sir.
I think this might be a Caltrans question, but I actually can't access my property now because of the number of trees that are piled up along the road. And I understand it's a big, you know, disposal issue.
You can't access your driveway or the rest of your property.
I have a driveway that's a loop, and I can't get in.
And it's on Highway 175.
Yes.
Okay.
Come see me.
Can you see him? See him right after? Okay. Yes, ma'am.
I'm very concerned about the potential mudslides. My children ride the school bus down to Middletown, and is there anything that we as a community can proactively be doing? Is there any sandbagging? Is there anything that I can do?
There was a report just issued last week from Cal Fire that they did on the watershed assessment, and in that is going to be there's a plan involved with that, and Cal OES has actually planned on bringing in sandbags and sand to be available for those type of things. They are working proactively to try to make sure that what we anticipate could be a tough winter, and what's going to cause that. And Caltrans as well, they're trying to ramp up. Everybody's trying to ramp up to get ready for it. I know the county is. We're working to make sure our culverts are clean, debris is clear in the ditches, so we can make sure that we're ready for an event like that.
So that information that I can come and help out, I've got some time on my hands, and come and make some sandbags or whatever, that's
yeah.
on the...
If that needs to happen at the time...
I'd rather be proactive than...
Yeah.
Reactive.
Check out our website, lakecountylhc.com. Yeah. Okay, and that's the other thing too that we've discussed today. I've got a request into the state to fund 25 different, at least a minimum of 25, but immediately for Cobb, Anderson Springs, Middletown and Hidden Valley, and Loch Lomond for early warning sirens. And we're also planning using, you know, making Nixel available. The sheriff is involved with, the sheriff has that available, and reverse 911. In the event of the fire, reverse 911 didn't work as well as we hoped that it would, because the power lines were burned down. But we're gonna have redundant systems that are available in the event of landslides and flood. And then those are the priority areas right now because of landslide. We're gonna have them around, you know, Spring Valley, Pillsbury, all the different communities, wherever there's a fire department or any place that we can place a early warning siren. So
I moved 5,000 sandbags to Middletown this morning from Kanakai Camp. So, you know, they're working on a larger supply, but we've already got something going.
Yeah. Go ahead, you and then Long.
So if we're one of the people who have like lone standing trees, they're 140 feet tall, and we also back up to 500 other acres that have similar spots of lone standing trees. They're not in the area of PG&E or AT&T or any other utility. If we're gonna rebuild, obviously we wanna see the trees there, but how do we know that they've even been evaluated as far as safety or, I mean, I don't want them gone, but I also don't wanna rebuild and then be crushed. I mean, these trees are huge, and the cones are falling and they're open. There's no signs of real life underneath them yet, but the stands above that area are huge.
There are other options available. You can call Greg's office.
Yeah, well, like he said, contact your neighbors. Like,
you can call Jim.
I can't contact my neighbors because they're like...
Well, I understand.
Only if it works. I mean, if you need somebody to come out and take a walk about on your property, just realize that the phone's been ringing. And, you know, but once you're in my calendar, come out, I'll meet you.
Yeah. The best thing to do would be to have an arborist evaluate your trees. You call, look them up in the phone book or online, find yourself an arborist that you're choosing, and ask them to give you an evaluation of your
Cal Fire team. Was there and told me on day 7, I believe that tree, but a lot changed.
Well, I don't know if they knew you may plan to build next to it too, you know.
I don't
or
care
is
whether
it gonna
I
be
build
the
there or somebody else builds there in the future. You got a 140-foot tree that's one of the only ones standing, but it's not. It exemplifies some of the things you guys are talking about, like
possible, but...
Well, like Jim said, though, that tree will be standing there next spring.
Yeah.
And
as
by
long
next,
as it... I don't know if it's protected. That's my other question.
By next spring, you'll know if that tree is dead or alive.
So if it's standing now, no one else is going to touch it?
Probably not, if it's not in an easement or not in some right-of-way.
Okay, so yeah. I don't have this damn garden.
You know, I'm just saying probably not. You can, you know, put a ribbon around it or something, you know, make some kind of designation. Yes, ma'am.
Big orange cross.
After the Board of Supervisors meeting last week, it was mentioned that there were, on the news, there were 107 potential mudslides in Lake County, mostly due to this fire. Is there some place that we can look to see where they're talking about 107 potential hazardous mudslides?
That's in that report that has been mentioned several times that you can get on the Valley Fire incident site on Cal Fire. I'm guessing that that will probably be on the Lake County LAC website.
I was able to access that here.
Yeah, and those sites are identified on there. By address as best as possible, and I believe there's a map as well.
Those sites that can be mitigated using labor, we're going to be working on them. We're using inmates or private contractors, but what we can mitigate, we're going to be working on.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to mention that Environmental Health has the debris removal right on the entry. They've amended it. They put another page on it that has what you want to keep and what you want removed. It's like a spreadsheet. If you haven't filled that out, it's now part of the form. So keep an eye out for it. But you filled out that right of entry form a week ago. It wasn't on it.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Question for Korinn. Is Anderson Stream one of the spots that you mentioned in this report?
It was mentioned in the report, yes. And in a lot of cases, there's not a lot that can be done, but there's a couple houses that remain on the creek there, and there's really no way to protect them from flooding because of their proximity. They're nearly in the creek. We had 6, 7, 8 engineers looking at these sites and thought, you know, this is where people need to be prepared to leave, you know, and have early warnings and stuff like that because of the, you know, site conditions. There was just not a lot that could be done at some of those sites.
And the only possibility is the sandbagging.
Yes.
Mike?
Have you had a chance to resolve the issue I raised with you with PG&E?
Mike, no disrespect, but you've raised several issues over the last 6 weeks. So. which one?
The third tier subs?
No.
From out of state?
No. No, you were going to follow up with me on who that company was.
Yeah, I have. Yeah.
Okay. Maybe you could mention that to him, but I was waiting to hear from who that company was before I brought that up. Any other questions? Yep.
I'm asking for someone else, but they're wondering what we can do to employ local people in this cleanup effort.
Well, the board already took action, and actually Pacific States has been really good. Mike taught the class down there. They have. I don't know what the percentage is that they have right now, but at one point there were 60% locals that were at the class, taking the class. So I know I'm happy with the effort that has gone into guaranteeing that locals are employed on this project. It's too big for just locals. I mean, it's huge. And the same thing with the truckers and the water trucks and the end ups. It's too big, so out-of-towners have to come in, but I'm satisfied that they are taken serious when we ask them to get us at least 50% of the locals hired. I think that's something they're making every attempt to do.
Are they on top of all of the different contractors that are being hired in all the areas?
They are. Pacific States has the contract with California Recycle to do the lots that we're talking about with the right of entry. There are some private contractors that are being hired by private individuals. Is pretty limited. I think when you got 1,280 or so home sites, probably 50 or 60 of those are actually going to be done by other contractors. And it's for the reasons that, you know, somebody over on Loch Lomond Road, they don't want to wait till it's their turn for a crew to come in, so they're going to clean them up right now. They still have to go through the same criteria. They've got to have testing done, which is a big deal. You can't get a building permit until you show that your property has been tested free of asbestos and heavy metals. Right, Ray?
Yes.
Yeah. So that, does that answer your question?
I think I'll let
okay.
her know.
And the question was, how many locals are being hired? What effort is made to hire locals? Yes, ma'am.
Where is the sign-up sheet for Korinn?
In the back.
Thank you. Back there. Yes, Kim. Kim, you do this what you do. That's what you move around. So I'll ask you again. Huh? Yeah, go ahead.
I will sign up for you.
Well, there is an area down at the D-Rock where you can sign up. Where's Jill? Jill Rizika, she left. Look on the Lake County LAC website. It has that information on there. There's a 40-hour hazmat training that's required, and that's been taught. I don't know if they're still, are they doing any more of those?
Last time I talked to Erin, she was saying
they were full.
On hold.
Yeah. That doesn't mean there aren't other jobs that are available, but you could check with the one-stop shop down in Lakeport, down on First Street. They also have that information available.
I have an important question. In light of the...
As opposed to the rest of these that we've heard?
Yes, this applies to everybody with their trees that are down on the property. Yeah. Has it been discussed to allow burning of big giant slash piles in the, once, you know, if they get tarped.
Control burning type.
If they get tarped, I'm talking bigger than 4x4 feet. Right. If there's a proper clearance, has that been discussed? Because of course we know the air pollution will happen, but that is the most economical way to get rid of trees that are already burned, but aren't burned enough, that are...
When burn permits are issued again, when the weather allows, if you're burning, you can go and just get a burn permit, but you have to have more than an acre. Are you talking about lots under an acre?
No.
Okay. If you have over an acre, you can come into the fire district office and get a burn permit. It's probably $24, I believe. At least it was last year, so it goes up a few cents every year. If you think you have piles that are larger than what's on the permit, we can come out and inspect it. And if it's so big, we can actually have you get a smoke management plan from air quality. It's the same price. They can write you a smoke management plan. You have to discuss it. It has to be certain burn days and all that. But it is possible to burn larger piles. You look at ag burning all the time. You look at giant tractor piles out in on the fields.
Right. But we're not farmers.
Right.
We are going to have, and then for the people that have less than 1 acre, that have 5 trees laying there right now, let's just use 5 at pretty good size, and they don't want firewood that's covered in soot because, you know, it's too messy.
Right.
Will there be exceptions to the normal procedures?
There can be an exception, but it's not the rule.
Are you talking about a lot where there's no foundation, where it's just a
yeah? What about the people? Like some people have probably had their clearing done, and all they have left now is trees that are messing up their property. I'm not talking about my property.
You know, I don't have an answer for that, but that's a good question. Let me check on that, because a lot of the rules that we have right now on burning on those small acres are, and I don't mean this in a bad way, this is just the reality. It was done so it doesn't negatively affect your neighbors. And in most cases, there are no neighbors right now. So there may be an option available. I'm not guaranteeing that, but there may be some options available. We'll have to work through air quality and with the fire departments to see if that something like that can happen. But I don't know.
Okay.
If you were to go do it right now, they would say no. Because the rule is no.
Well, right, so maybe there's something in the presidential declaration of emergency that can let those rules be waived.
I assure you, we will be talking to air quality about that, because we know it's going to be a big issue. And I do want the stuff to be burned up or chipped.
Yeah.
So I want to help you get it burned.
Right.
So I'll be your advocate with air quality. We'll see what we can do.
Okay.
Yeah, and I feel the same way Jim does on that, so we'll...
New Year's Eve, come on over. We'll have a big
fire.
I know. Yeah. See, it's bonfire.
Just had one. any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
I'm trying to do a community building project with totem poles and sculptures, having different people participate to do some of the carvings.
So if anybody wants to donate a tree or trees for us to use for that, that would be great.
What's your contact information?
I didn't bring any.
Get with her after the meeting. Any other questions? If not, we're going to put chairs away.
Just quick, I missed the part about culverts. Is the county going to come through and work on the culverts?
The county's going to be working on county culverts. The state's going to be working on state highway culverts.
Unlike in our subdivisions and like up
yes.
where we are.
Yes, yeah.
Okay, so we don't need to try to get people together in the neighborhood.
Unless they're on your property. Unless the culverts are on your property. If they're not, it's the county responsibility. And they will be in there. Well, that's something that we're, if we've got a plan in place for that, to take care of it. Thank you again. Thank you all for coming. If you are so inclined, we're going to put chairs away.
About PG&E?
Oh, yeah, PG&E. Anybody has a PG&E question? Where are you going to be? How about off to the side? That way we can put chairs away. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.